What's up? I'm Kesha. I did have sexy times with a ghost, and it was fun and erotic and spooky, and it was weird, but it did happen. It happened in my house. I used to live up Laurel Canyon in this like flop house, and there was a spirit there that just wouldn't let me sleep.
You're listening to the Mystic Menagerie Podcast, your regular descent into the world of alternative entertainment, art, and culture. Bolt the door, light the fire, and pour yourself a glass of Virgin Rouge, and let your hosts, Dan Baines and Lord Freddie Valentine, guide you through the Stygian depths of your darkest delights. Warning. Listener discretion is advised.
Hello and welcome to the Mystic Menagerie Podcast, episode 20. It's crazy we've got to 20 episodes, isn't it?
It is. It's amazing. We're certainly getting there. I mean, next month we're 21. We get the key to the door. Never been 21 before.
It's almost like we've raised this stroppy child. Do you know what I mean? It starts off very young. Do you know what I mean? Very innocent in the first few podcasts. I mean, not knowing what's going on really.
Yeah.
Then during the sort of teaser, it's very confident. Do you know what I mean? You know, starts hanging out with Right Said Fred and people like this. You know, very a lot of confidence there. And now it's reaching that level of maturity.
You know, it's a good analogy. That is, we went through probably episode 17, 18, 19, we went through a bit of a tearaway stage where we lost our direction, went a bit crazy, off the rails, you know, got pissed a lot, and, well, in a more sort of vocal sense. And now we're back on track, we're getting into the 20s, we're starting to mature a little bit. I just hope that when we get to sort of episode 80 or 90, we don't start forgetting things and wandering off and urinating everywhere.
Exactly, yeah. But I suppose also when you get to age, when you're in your 80s, you can say what you like and not give a damn.
True. You can get away with all sorts when you're in your 80s. You can get away with racism, being in politically correct,
nicking things from shops. And, oh, little old man, oh, I forgot, I didn't know, I thought I'd pay for it. Old man, he must have a bit of dementia. You know,
get away. I can't wait till I get to that age. I'm going to be a fucking nightmare.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I've got a theory that any British man, you know, once they're sort of 60, 70, they turn into either Victor Meldrew, Alf Garnett, or Basil Fawlty.
Yeah.
You know, you're destined to be one of those, or even a combination of them, of those characters. I think it's like, you know, you have primary senses. People say that some people, their sense of smell is stronger than their sense of vision, you know, or their sense of, they visualise things stronger than they hear things. I think you have those three characteristics when you're older: Basil Fawlty, Alf Garnett, and Victor Meldrew. One of them is your prime one, and the other two are in the background as well, I feel.
I think they're good traits to have. I mean, I find myself shouting at the television already. I'm at the age now, you know, since I've gone over the hill of 40, I will sit there and shout at the TV as if the person on the TV can actually hear me shouting at them. And it's usually abuse as well. I shout abuse at the television, which is why I don't really watch TV until the kids have gone to bed, because it's not the watershed that they have to worry about. It's it's the language I use, and the physical violence as well.
It's quite therapeutic, you know, but to touch your gut, because there's so many annoying people on TV or talentless people these days that you can't help but shout at them. Do you know what I mean? I wonder if it was in real. I mean, I see someone like Vernon Kay on television, I think, what can he do? He's talentless, you know. And I think, like, you know, Bruce Forsyth, he was a game show host, he could tap dance, he could play piano. If you put a Vernon Kay theatre show on, what could he do? Nothing.
No, he could text page 3 models to send them pictures of themselves topless, which is a bit of a dumb thing to do if you think about it. If you're having an affair with a page 3 girl, you go to the level to get yourself a mobile phone with a number on it so your missus doesn't find out. And what do you get the page 3 girl to do? You get her to send a picture of herself topless to you. Why doesn't you just get the fucking newspaper?
Exactly, yeah.
Shows the level of intellect you're dealing with.
You can get it for free, yeah. I mean, once I a lot of people on TV these days I can't stand because they're very insipid and they're famous for nothing. You know, they used to, years ago, someone was famous because they did something worthwhile. You know?
Yeah.
And I remember going to a friend of mine, he's a comedian, and he has a lot of celebrities. He does his TV shows. And Vernon Kay was there, one of them. And he's just like a yob. In real life, he's as obnoxious as you expect him to be. I mean, when you see him on television, he's you know when like a yobbish lout has to go to a family gathering and they put a suit on, they're trying to behave themselves a bit.
Yeah.
That's what he's like on television. Mm. But he was like heckling for the whole show and shouting and things out. And he had a couple of friends with him, but trying to create attention for himself all the time. You know, I'm really surprised he hasn't got a kicking. I really am.
He probably has. But he just likes to keep it under wraps. It's not the sort of thing you advertise, is it? I mean, I don't advertise the fact that I've been had my head kicked in a few times. but I've just said it on the podcast, yeah. So, you know, if at least a few thousand global listeners will now find out. But, you know, I'm a bloke and these things happen.
These things do happen in life, you know. Everyone has to have a kicking at one. As long as you're given as many kickings as you receive, then it sort of balances things out. It's the level of karma here. But that night, you know, I thought Vernon Kay, I really wanted to hit him. But I was sitting, it was a VIP show. I was sitting next to Martin McCutcheon. You don't behave like that in front of Martin McCutcheon. You behave yourself. You're a gentleman. You know, so I thought, you know.
That's it.
Vernon Kay, very lucky that night. If I was sitting next to somebody that I didn't like, you know what I mean, or didn't have respect for, you know, I probably would have given him a slap, you know.
Well, I don't find myself shouting at podcasts. That's one thing. I listen to podcasts all day, every day in the studio, and I listen probably, I subscribe to probably in the region of 100 podcasts that I listen to, and the only one I've ever shouted at, which is the one we covered a few shows ago, which is the one where the chap was on about having a lazy on instead of a liaison.
And,
I did shout at that because I kept shouting, it's fucking liaison, not lazy on. And that was the only time I've had a bit of verbal abuse at the Amazon Kindle that was plugged into the wall.
Yeah. But, are they quite easy to sort of, I mean, I don't know how strong these Kindles and things are. If you threw it across the room and, you know, because years ago, things were quite sturdy, you know, because of the anger issue, like television, people thump the top of the television and stuff like that, and it still worked. You know, but these days things are quite fragile, aren't they?
You know, if you threw your mobile phone, it'd probably break. But in like the 80s, if you threw a Mark I Sony Walkman at someone's head, you'd probably kill them.
Yeah, exactly. The same
it'd be like having ISIS drop a breeze block on your head.
Exactly. You know, the Discmans were even bigger. You could frisbee them, whack someone's eye out. It's like you know, the old Atari, the joysticks on the old Atari. They were sturdy. So if you were playing a game and you didn't do very well at it, you could throw that across the room. You know what I mean? And kick the Atari across the room, and it still worked. Mm. But these PlayStation, these fragile ones, with little buttons on. I'm sure all the buttons would fall out and it's break somehow. They're quite fragile, aren't they? They're not sturdy.
They are. But they're not built to last. You know, and we all know that the power of marketing and things is. Things are given a life so that in 3 or 4 years' time they're either obsolete or they're broken, so you've got to go and buy a new one. So no one builds anything to last really anymore.
Well, like the TV shows as well. I mean, everyone went on about Lost, how wonderful, it's the best program ever, and then now
it's Lost.
I'll tell you where it is, it's down a car boot sale for £1 complete box set.
That's it.
Well, same with everything else, like Breaking Bad, that was the thing, and now that's going to be down the old. If you go down, you know, the trade exchange shop, whatever, you could probably get the whole complete collection. Blu-ray for £3.
It's when Soprano, you see biographies down Poundland. You know, if you go down, I usually go down Poundland to get a few, like, I don't know, sanding blocks and sandpaper and tools and little things like that, and you always browse, there's a little book section in there, and there's always like Robbie Williams autobiography, and it's like it's actually on sale, so it's actually 50p and not even a pound. Can you imagine if you're Robbie Williams and you're going through Poundland?
Yeah.
And you see your own book in there for 50p. The story of your life is worth that. And then no one is actually buying it, even at that price.
That'd be heartbreaking. I mean, the funniest one I saw was, do you remember that bloke? I think his name was Matt Cardle, and he won the X Factor the year that Wagner was on.
Yeah.
And literally, he won the X Factor. He had a single out, Christmas number one, and then after that, he had an autobiography out. And I thought, and that was going down to like a pound in the works, you know. And I thought, what's his story? I was a painter and decorator. I went on the X Factor. I won it. End of story.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's hardly like Brian Wilson. Yeah, I took loads of acid, stayed in bed for 6 years, sold millions of records around the world, went bonkers. You know, there's not a story to it. And people, you know, they publish books, autobiographies, especially when you're old, isn't it? And you had a life, not these
ridiculous
things.
Yeah, not halfway
through. Not someone's just been born, you know.
Let's get back on track. We are a paranormal and alternative arts podcast at the end of the day. And I suppose Robbie Williams doesn't really fall into that.
No, I think it's paranormal. It's a mystery how why people like him.
It's a mystery of how these people actually get famous and become so prevalent in our society. In fact, it's scary. I think it's more scary than some of the conspiracy theories out there.
Oh, definitely. And there's a lot more of those. I mean, talking of conspiracy theories, just a recap of what's happened. You know, like we were saying before about the David Bowie things, that there's even more popping up about.
Yeah.
There's one saying that, you know, he went to Switzerland to one of these clinics now. You know, these euthanasia clinics.
Assisted suicide, yeah.
Yeah, because the thing is that the saying is it seems very convenient that he knew he had cancer. He was very ill. He has his birthday. His album comes out. And then obviously sees the response of the album. And then next minute he's dead. And it's a very rush, quick funeral, you know. So that's the conspiracy theory there, that he thought, well, once the album comes out, then I'm going to go after. And he's got a house in Switzerland, he's living in Switzerland, didn't he? So he's got connections over there and a home over there, I believe.
Yeah.
So there's someone on the internet saying that as well, that is all planned.
Yeah, and with Prince dying as well last week.
Ooh, a lot of rumours about Prince. How do you reckon he died? I mean, this is quite a controversial subject here, but I've read some rumours online and some of them sound quite feasible.
Yeah, he lived such a reclusive lifestyle, I don't really know anything about him. You know, Raspberry Beret, he was really the only thing I ever listened to, and Little Red Corvette. That was the period I liked Prince. Sort of
80s, he was 80s. Brilliant, yeah.
After that, when he went all albums. Epic albums and New Power Generation, or not.
That's it. Yeah,
not really my thing.
No, he lost the melodies. I mean, like Purple Rain, good album. I like Sign of the Times. 1999, good album. Was that psychedelic one, Around the World in a Day, Parade? But after that, I think we have to boil. But the story, I don't know the truth. He died, you know. But there's some rumours around the internet, and whether they're true or not, we may never find out the truth. But yeah, what the news was saying is that he had the flu, and then he suddenly died. Right, which unless there's a new sort of, you know, strain of flu which can kill healthy men, there's something odd about this. But what the people are saying on the internet is that apparently he's had HIV,
right?
And he had it since the early 90s or 80s, and he kept it very quiet. And that's one reason why he's private. He was very quiet about it. I think because in the 80s there was very much a stigma about AIDS, wasn't it? You know, it was very much.
Oh yeah, it was like you had Ebola basically.
You
were given a severe wide berth if you said you had AIDS.
Exactly. People didn't understand it, you know. And always said he had HIV, and because he's a Jehovah's Witness, you know, they don't believe in medicine or blood transfusion. They believe in prayer. And apparently, what people are saying is he's been taking this medicine to manage the HIV, which, you know, like you can take a medicine these days and you can live it and it doesn't go into AIDS. Well, apparently, these Jehovah's Witness friends of his said, oh, you should be taking that medicine. This is like a while ago. You should be praying instead because God doesn't believe in medicine. You've got to go by prayer. So he stopped taking this medicine, which is HIV. And then, of course, no defence system there. Do you know what I mean? Developed into AIDS. He got the flu and the flu killed him because he had no defence system there. His immune system was working because of that.
If that's the truth, then more the fool him. I mean, this whole Jehovah's Witness thing is just crazy. I mean, all religion pretty much is crazy.
Paganism is all right, or Satanism, I think. It's okay.
Yeah, well, it's one of those, what drives people to destroy their own physical life here in the hope that so there's something better afterwards where there's no actual proof. I just, I do want to believe in stuff. You know, I think we've spoken about this before. You know, the prospect of death scares the shit out of me. I probably think about it every day and, you know, how long am I going to live for and all this. Because for me, it's a one chance. You've got one shot. And after that, there's no scientific proof, or no, I don't think even there's any spiritual proof, to be honest, that there is anything after we die. Not in a sense that we're conscious of it, you know, like, I've just been run over by a bus, but oh, look at me now, I'm kind of in a garden with all my family drinking tea. I think that's a load of bollocks. Obviously, science at some stage might prove that some form of energy remains after we die, like some residual energy, which means that things that we've done in the past are kind of can be seen again, almost like a recording, you know, like a radio, or a film recording. I think that there might be something in that. But your actual physical, the thing that drives your physical body when you're alive, the spirit, I suppose.
Yeah,
I'm a bit skeptical about that.
I've seen things that have made me feel there is something there, that there is something after death. Do you know what I mean? Or there is some energy does live on. You know, whether it's like a ghost or joining you're floating around, or the energy's still there. It's like, you know, one big system out there. Do you know what I mean? And your energy goes out there. You know, there's something definitely there. I feel, from what I've seen, experience with the things I've done. But I say, as regarding religion, like organized religions, I don't really feel any of them are, they're storybooks, you know. I don't really believe, I mean, the closest to what I believe in is the Druids or paganism, because you can see that around you. It's about nature, it's about animals, about, you know, about the elements, and you can see that with your own eyes.
Yeah,
it's there, you know. And of course, to do with magic and spells and stuff like that, sometimes if you will something strong enough or you drive it strong enough, you can make things happen. Mm. You know, so I do have strong beliefs in that area. But regarding all this stuff like Christianity and Islam, it just seems like a story. It's like someone finding Harry Potter in, like, you know, 1,000 years time and saying, you know, well, I'll follow this book to the T, this great man lived called Harry Potter and he learned all these great things. And, you know, you could believe any book like that, or Noddy, any book you could take and see it. But I think that people following something without question, is really weird. Because when I was studying, like, with witches and pagans, basically what they told you when learning that is that you question things, you know, you follow your beliefs, how you feel, what you feel is right.
Yeah.
You know, if you feel that you go up to a tree and you get energy, you do that. If you feel that, you know, the sun gives you energy, then you go towards that. If you feel in tune with plants, you know, is whatever you feel is right, you follow. There's no strict rules as such.
No.
Other than that, you go by what you feel in your heart is right, or what you feel, you know, is a way of doing things, you know. Like when they were casting spells in this coven I was in, is that sometimes you cast the spells how you feel was the right way to do it, by your own personal energy. So it's very individual. It's a religion based on the individual rather than a cult or a group or a mass way of thinking.
Yeah, well, that's what, you know, Islam, Christianity, all of these were originally cults anyway, that were promoted through negative actions. You know, it was adopted by the Roman army because...
Yeah.
Christians are more devout than pagans, and Christians will sacrifice their lives for the greater good. Therefore, the Romans thought, oh, we'll have a bit of that because they'll make them better fighters. Promotion through negativity to the point where it is today, where it is the epitome, and it's the source of all of the shit that's happening in the world. It revolves around Christianity and Islam, and that is it. You know, you can trail it all back. Child abuse, murder, war, everything. It revolves around pretty much those two things. And
it's a form of control as well, isn't it, really?
It is, yeah.
You know, when you look at, like, pagans, they're what you would call free spirits, you know? Like, we had Arthur on the show, and he's a free spirit. He does what he wants. He goes by what he feels is right, you know? He doesn't follow any strict regime. Mm. Whereas when you look at Christianity, Islam, years ago there was no or law system around those times. So if someone did something bad, you know, they could have a mob go after them or something like that. But there was no real proper structured, you know, legal system or policing there. So if they say to them, look, if you do something bad, then you're going to go to hell. That was like saying, if you kill someone, you're going to go to prison. You know what I mean? So people followed that, you know, and because those days, the people that read books were fewer. You know, there wasn't many people that read. So the peasants tended to believe the educated people. So it's a case of, if they say it, it must be true. It's like when people say it's in the paper, it must be true, or the doctor told me it must be true. Those days, they trusted people that could read. You know, and I feel that these days, to have these sort of same things happening and people not questioning it is very odd. I mean, like I say, over here in the UK, Christianity is not really that much of a big deal anymore.
It's not, no. It's on the decline. I think anyone who went to church in the 70s, like when we were young, and then goes into church now, there'll be they'll be shocked at the amount of how many people go there now. It's and that generation are slowly dying off. So you've got the new breed of sort of new age Christians and stuff going, and obviously the mosques are recruiting.
Yeah,
whatever they're recruiting.
Yeah, that's the strongest thing, and that's the control thing as well. And I think what they prey on is the fact that, you know, is the poor me kind of thing. Everyone is against us. Let's all join together, and people are attracted towards that. You know, but like with Christianity, I feel that as a religion, it's very controlling, very brainwashy, in some ways. Because I know a couple of people that have become born again Christians that are friends of mine, and that's all they talk about.
Yeah,
it's all they're interested in. It's like a friend of mine who before, he was very much into the occult. He's very much into sort of spiritual stuff. His favourite films were things like Tim Burton and stuff like that. He likes goth. He used to be a goth when he was younger. He likes very abstract music, very out there stuff. Frank Zappa, who was very anti-religion, stuff like that. But something happened to him, and he bumped into these Christians, and he overnight became a full born again Christian. And now he just talks about Jesus, and he works in a church. He works like a phone line, you know, helping people to pray for them and stuff like that. And if you can't have a conversation with him about anything, because all the music he used to like, he doesn't like anything from the past anymore. Tim Burton films, doesn't watch them, they're the work of the devil. Now he watches, like, you know, Jesus of Nazareth and stuff like that. He's really, like, erased his life. And he did make a statement a while ago on Facebook saying that he had a laptop of his which broke, and he had to have it repaired. And basically he lost all of his hard drive. And he said basically it's a new laptop with a new stuff on it. And it's representative of his life. The whole memory's been erased, and there's a new start here, and that's what he sees himself as being, a different person, and everything he ever liked or was into in his life is gone.
Yeah,
and all his life is now is Jesus, and he listened to podcasts about Jesus, he only listened to prayer music, and he was pretty out there bloke before, out there, you know, open minded. But yeah, it's fun. And another geezer I know, he was involved. I mean, sometimes people get involved in something really bad, and then they become a Christian, like they become an alcoholic, or they get involved in prison. Because I've noticed that in prisons, when people are at their lowest point, you get priests coming in there, talking to them.
You know, there are some people from a religious background who listen to this show, and we're not going to alienate them or make enemies of them by us preaching our disbelief, because I'm sure if they were given the same opportunity, they would promote their belief to us. So,
yeah,
it's a double-edged sword. Yeah, it's just that, and that's life. Nothing's ever going to change.
No. I mean, people should be able to believe what they like, as long as it doesn't harm anybody else. But sometimes it does harm other people, sometimes it does harm themselves. So,
it does do a lot of harm to other people.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, you probably do, but there's probably not as many atheists who have abused young choir boys as there are priests.
Well, a lot of magicians say they're atheists, don't they? Because Darren Brown doesn't have atheism. A lot of magicians say they're atheists. So,
what have we got on the show today then, Freddie?
Right, we've got tons this week. It's a very packed show, isn't it? Of course, we've got the fantastic Fortean Oracle with Nathan coming up as well, which is always a treat, isn't it?
It is. We're talking about sexy spooks. So we're talking about ghosts that like to still interact with the living. Or diddle with the living, should I say?
Exactly, yeah.
So we'll see what Nathan makes of that.
It's got to be like a name for that, isn't it? It's like, you know, yeah, bestiality for animals and whatever. It's got to be some name for people, you know.
I think there is a name for it, and we'll cover it later on in the show. I can't remember what it is, but we'll be talking the things like the case of the entity, the possibility that, you know, actual spirits can rape you, or it's not a particularly nice subject, but some of it's quite nice. There's two girls who allow themselves to be tinkered with by ghosts, so we'll talk about that as well.
We'll see if Nathan's had an experience with that. I bet he has.
I bet he's I'm not sure what, but I'm sure he's had some sexual interaction with the afterlife.
As long as it's not Michael Jackson.
As long as it's not Michael Jackson, no. We've also got an interview with Michael Day.
Yeah, Michael Day is a New Age leader. He's like a guru, a tarot reader. Very interesting bloke. And he's a very great bloke to have on the show. It's a really good interview, actually, isn't it? It's very interesting.
It is, yeah. This guy actually takes celebrities out and spiritually guides them in their shopping and their choice of things they buy. Is that correct?
Yeah, he does all sorts of stuff like that. And he goes to Barbados and does readings over there. He's very much a... He does all sorts of things, you know what I mean? He's like a celebrity's advisor. He does tarot readings for around the world. Barbados, as I say, is very well known over there. Brilliant bloke, you know. I've worked with him a few times on shows that we've done and spiritual events and cabaret events. He's a real nice bloke, but very interesting person to talk to. So he's a great guest. I'm sure that everyone listening will enjoy an interview with him. And also we've got Tom's going to come back on the show, isn't he? Tom Burgess.
Yeah, we've got he's going to come back on and give us a quick overview of a new project, which a film project, a book project, a graphic novel project. I think it's an all-encompassing project, basically.
Yeah.
Without wanting to overuse the word project. It's really interesting. It's called Ghoster, and he's going to be on later in the show to talk about that with us. So what I think we'll do now is we'll take a short break, and then we'll come back with Our Bizarre Life.
Michael! Are you all right? It was horrible. There were monsters and zombies. I was in a graveyard. It was terrible.
Go to sleep, Michael. It was just a silly nightmare.
You sure, Mom?
Yes, darling.
Okay. Good night, Mom.
Good night, Michael.
It's time to find out what's been going on in our bizarre lives. Hello and welcome back to the Mystic Menagerie podcast, episode 20. And now we're going to cover our bizarre life to find out what myself and Dan have been up to over the last month or so, or since you last heard from us. Or if you listen to the podcast out of order, it's going to be a bit strange. But, you know, this is what's been happening in the last month. So, yeah, Dan, what have you been up to this month? Anything interesting, anything unusual?
Yeah, it's all go in the studio at the moment. So anyone who follows me on the magic and prop side and also follows my blog will know I'm working on Dolly Darko 2. So For those who don't know what Dolly Darko is, it's probably my biggest selling product to date, and it's a haunted doll. So the old one used to throw things around and ring bells on her own. This one takes it a stage further. So wow. I think I may have mentioned it in the last show, where I 3D scanned all of her components, and then I can actually print a full doll now, which makes her really light and also makes her hollow as well, which is great for putting things inside to make her move around. But there's an interesting article actually came out today, and it's in my blog. So if you go to danbaines.com and go to the blog, it's called "And the Haunted Doll Webcast." Now, get this, I read this. How many... Amongst the bizarre magic scene, there's a lot of haunted doll routines and stories, isn't there? And
yeah,
there's kind of a set template when you do a haunted... Well, I would say now there is. You know, you can always tell when something's been fabricated, because we write so many routines. Well, when we do write our routines, we try to make them a little bit sort of more out of the ordinary and more believable. But there are some... If you're new to bizarre magic, there's always a few things that you put into the recipe for your story, which always to me highlight it as being a bit suspicious. So basically, they've got this thing called "Anne the Haunted Doll Webcast," and it's a haunted doll that's on a live web stream, and they're asking people to watch it to see if it moves and does things, right? But get this as a backstory, okay? So it says, who is Anne? It says, the original was a 13-year-old girl treated for tuberculosis at Waverley Hills Sanatorium in the early 1900s. One of Anne's caretakers, a very devoted and attached woman named Lois, written really badly. I'm reading this directly from the actual website as well. Basically, without reading any more because it's so terribly written, 13-year-old girl has tuberculosis, there's a caretaker, gives her a doll, and basically this doll gets passed around all the dying children as they die, and this doll is now haunted. So you've got all the typical things there. You've got they've got the dying children, you've got Waverley Hills Sanatorium,
wow,
the haunted doll. It's just a typical bizarre magic routine. I don't think a lot of research went into actually writing it, but it's coincides with the fact that it's the new season of the Haunted Collector starting on Destination America on Tuesday. So I wonder if it's a marketing campaign. What do you reckon?
Possibly could be a film, something like that.
Yeah, but if you look at the doll,
Charlie.
Yeah, the doll itself is not an antique doll from the 1900s. I mean, it's been engineered so poorly. The doll is one of those off-the-shelf dolls that, you know, that mums have in cabinets. You know, they collect those dolls that are dressed in period clothing.
Yeah.
So it's not a doll that's been handed around lots of dying children over the years. This is an off-the-shelf, straight-out-of-the-packet doll. You can actually look at the video on my website. If you go to danbaines.com and scroll down, there's a video of one of the girls who works for the TV company unpacking the doll. And it is just it's a doll from a shop, or from a charity shop or a thrift shop. It's not what you would consider to be a period doll of that time. You know, if you've seen an antique doll, you know, children play with dolls, and I think any toy that a child has loved is going to be pretty knackered.
It is.
This hasn't even got any dirt on it. It's just a out of the box doll. So
unless there was a Victorian nerd, like, you know, the ones who collect Star Wars figures and kept in its box for like 100 odd years.
Yeah, but the children would have still had hold of it, wouldn't they, at the hospital?
I suppose so.
Shame on you, Destination America. You should have put a bit more research into your story and come to me, because I'd have done it a hell of a lot better.
Exactly. Yeah.
So there's that. Another thing that happened as well, which is an odd thing, and it's still puzzling me right now, and I think we should cover this in the arcane chapters later on, because it opens a whole can of worms. But a few months ago on my blog again, I covered a post where I discussed a publication called The Occult Review, which it's an old magazine that's out of print, and it covered it's basically devoted to the investigation of the supernatural and the study of psychological problems. It's called The Occult Review, and this one was from 1921, and there was a really big article on fairies in it. Now, in this article, it mentions a book which is quite difficult to get hold of, and it actually covers basically, this book is meant to be the best preserved collection of writings about fairy traditions and elemental teachings of what it says is a very ancient faith. So it basically covers the rituals you would go through in order to see fairies, you know, go to fairyland and all this. So I actually found a copy of this book. I'm not going to mention what it's called for reasons I'll mention later on, but I ordered a copy of this book. It was expensive. Even though this article was written in 1921, the book was written in 1900, and I got almost a pristine copy of it. I got it. It got sent to my house, and I had it. And then, all of a sudden, it vanished. I've no idea where it has gone. I put it with two other books. I put it with a book called The Vanishing People, and also I put it with The White People by Arthur Machen. I kept all three books together because I was building like a collection of, I wouldn't say ancient, but I'm trying to collect as much original writings of fairy folklore which points towards real things. So this book is just completely vanished, to the point where, now this is strange as well, when I actually tried to remember what the book was called, I couldn't even remember the title of the book or even what colour the jacket of the book was. So it's almost like I had it and imagined it, but I did have it. I physically had the book, but I cannot find it anywhere. And I'm really quite anal with, you know, I've got two young boys, so everything I've got is really carefully looked after, and if I've got a book, it goes on the bookshelf, and you know, everything is in its place. But this book has just vanished. I cannot find it anywhere, and other than just having to flick through it, I can't remember anything about it. I actually go back to the site I bought it from to find out that it was actually a blue book, and I couldn't remember the title of the book either. So
I mean, the fairies and the history of them. Have you ever read the book called The Burning of Bridget Cleary before? It's a true story.
No.
It's written by Angela Burke. It's based in Ireland. And it was this woman was killed by her husband in 1895.
Okay.
He burnt her to death because what he believed was her personality had been abducted by fairies. Right. Or she had been abducted by fairies and been replaced by a changeling.
Okay.
And basically, you know, she said that he basically didn't kill, when he went to court, he said, "I didn't kill my wife, I killed the changeling," and that was his defence in court.
It wasn't his real wife, she'd been swapped.
He set fire to her. But it's covered in the newspapers and everything. It's a big story at the time. There was a documentary, I think, on Channel 4.
Mm.
But yeah, basically, in Ireland, there's still, even in that sort of, I suppose, fairly recent times, you know, but there's a strong belief of fairies there then.
Yeah.
But it's a really interesting story. I mean, if you're interested, it's worth having a look at that book.
Yeah, I'll have a look at that. But it's one of these things. It's almost like this book doesn't want to be discovered. I sort of found the title purely by accident, ordered a copy of it, and now it's disappeared.
Strange, isn't it?
I've even asked for it back. I've done the old thing, you know, stand in the middle of the room, please can I have my copy of blah, blah, blah back, please. And to date, nothing has appeared. So, and I look for it all the time. Yeah, I'm always on the lookout. There's only so many places it can be, and it's just gone. So
yeah, strange. Taken by fairies. They didn't want you to know about it.
Well, yeah, it's you know, the occult review does cover it, and it actually, you know, it actually points towards this book as it just basically actually says it is a preservation of elemental teachings of an ancient faith that predates Christianity. So it has all these little things in there that would point to I suppose. I know I didn't get the opportunity to read it, but how to see fairies, or at least be in the right sort of vicinity of things. So
yeah,
if it does appear, I'll let you know. But it's completely gone.
It's a strong tradition with fairies and elementals, you know, going way, way, way back. It's almost like that's trying to, over the years, like Christianity and whatnot, as we said, they tried to sort of eradicate all these beliefs. Do you know what I mean? And I don't think believing in fairies is crazier than believing in Jesus or anything like that or some of the things. Do you know what I mean? I don't think it's crazier. But if you actually said to somebody, I believe in fairies and I saw them, people would think you're a nutcase. But if you say, I saw the Virgin Mary crying to me, or statue crying, and Jesus came to me, they wouldn't say you were crazy. That's what I find really strange about this, you know. But the traditional fairies goes way back.
What makes the topic of fairies so interesting, in the respect that it is so shunned by normal society. Obviously, it's been adopted by the whole Disney thing. You know, if you talk about fairies, people automatically think of little girls in tutus with wands. And that's it. That's as far as it goes. So if you wanted to hide anything that actually had some sort of relevance, or if you wanted to hide something that was very dangerous, you would hide it in a place like that, because it's just a place that's going to get no coverage and it's just going to be laughed at straight away.
It's good. It looks as if it's a childlike thing, and like, if you believe in fairies, then you're childlike and a bit backwards. That's what it's trying to make it look like, you know what I mean? It's by putting it in that context, you know.
It's almost like saying it's, if you had like a recipe to make a nuclear bomb, for example, but the way you would hide it, you could hide it by dressing it up in some sort of fairy tale, or put it in a box that's labelled fairies, because no one in their right mind would look in it with any sense of, you know, belief. They would look at it and think, look at this, you know. Just because it gets labelled with fairy folklore, it's automatically laughed out and dismissed as being bullshit. So it is interesting. There's a lot of ties in with the occult research departments of World War II, and obviously the Germans were all into their paganism and searching back into all this type of folklore. It almost looks like they were onto something at some point, but obviously as soon as the Second World War was over, all of that research was dropped, and I don't know where it all that information is now. But if they were onto something, it's almost like, well, you know, during that time where we found all this information, we read all these old books and found what could be the basis of something true and paranormal, we'll dress it up into something that's so ridiculous that no one will ever look there. And then hence the Disney fairy was born.
Definitely, yeah. It'd be like a term of an insult, or it'll make, you know, look silly. The thing is with fairies is a lot of that, you've got countries that are more rural, shall we say, or less touched by modern times, they still have those beliefs there. I mean, a lot of people, like Eastern Europe, some of the countries in Eastern Europe, less developed countries, or the ones that are more traditional, shall we say, still have belief systems that actually cover that. Because I know some people from places like Lithuania, Romania, and they still have, they're kind of like not sure if it's real, but they want to be on the safe side. It's a bit like, you know, like walking under a ladder. You think, well, it's probably a load of bollocks, but I'm not going to walk on that ladder in case I have bad luck, you know. They're actually towards fairies is a bit like, you know, well, I'm not sure if they're real or not, but I don't want to risk it because they might be, you know. It seems to be that sort of attitude. And I've had stories from people about fairies and people seeing fairies and being abducted by them and stuff like that, and going in the woods, and this is from people that from modern times, you know. Like I say, I had a friend from Lithuania saying that there's a lot of paganism and belief in elementals there. I mean, part of the country is Catholic. I think Catholic religion came over there. There's a lot of Catholics in Lithuania. But there's also, like, the more rural parts out in the countryside. You know, I suppose we would have places like Devon and places like that. They're equivalent of that. They still believe in paganism and fairies and nature elements and stuff like that. And vampires as well. So there's quite a lot of beliefs.
Werewolves.
And it's almost a case of, like, this friend of mine is a Catholic. He sort of like dismisses it a bit, but sort of says, I don't want to upset it in case it's real, you know. It seems to be that sort of attitude, really. And so that book I was saying, that Bridget Cleary, The Burning of... It's in Ireland, but there's still like that's quite a rural country in parts of it, you know, where there's untouched by modern
times. Fairy folklore in like the Republic of Ireland is still very prevalent, as it is with Iceland and the Scandinavian countries. It's still part of their folklore, and it hasn't been dressed up in a way that's ridiculed. It's still, you know, a firm part of their heritage. Whereas now, in the UK, I mean, I've done so many fairy interviews to know the fact that every radio interviewer or TV interviewer who's interviewed me does it with a tongue in the cheek. It's almost like when Terry Wogan interviewed
David Icke.
Yeah, yeah, it's all done in that kind of well, you know, tell us about the fairies then, and it's done like that.
Yeah.
I think people who dig around too much in fairy folklore as well can either, they can be rewarded, and it's also like a strange curse in a way as well. The guy who took the photographs of the fairies, I think it was 2 years ago, they looked like mayflies dancing in the sun. It was the Rossendale fairies, and yeah, it was John Hyatt who took the photographs. And he took those photographs, and since then he's had like a brain tumour or something, which he's recovered from, which is quite strange. Obviously I've not, touch wood, had any medical ailments, but
yeah,
I did lose my career over the whole fairy incident. But however, by carrying on down that fairy path, for want of a better word, I'm actually better off now than I was before, mentally better and financially better, and I'm in a better place. And the more I hang around in this area, things only seem to be getting better for me. So in a weird way, you know, I don't know why this book's vanished. The skeptics would say, oh, I've just misplaced it, or it's been thrown away. But you know, I know for a fact that I kept it with two other books specifically for the purpose of research, and it has just literally vanished out of the house.
Away with the fairies, literally.
It is away with the fairies, yeah. And it makes me wonder what was in it that was so important that it's gone.
Yeah, if I do, know. Yeah,
if I do find it, I'll let people know. But I paid a lot of money for it as well. If you pay a lot of money for something, you're going to make sure you know where it is, aren't you?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, of course you are.
You don't go out and buy a new iPad and then leave it somewhere where you're going to forget about it. You know, it's always somewhere where you know it is. And it was the same thing with this book, and it's gone. So
it's strange, isn't it?
Mysterious. Yeah. So other than that, and following around lost books, I've not really done much else. I've been doing a bit of drone flying. Not been to any spooky places. I've done quite a lot of shooting on beaches and stuff where movies have been shot.
Brilliant.
So Camber Sands down in down south, where they filmed a lot of the D-Day landings.
Carry on for that camel, of course.
Yeah, there. Carry on for that camel. Yeah, the Monument Men with George Clooney. So yeah, it's good. We had a nice time. I'll have more news next month. We're actually going on some more sort of more urban exploration shoots. But that's it for me. What about you, Freddie?
Yeah, as I was saying, we're talking about the stuff that we're saying about there. We have got some new features coming up on the show. From now, as we are keeping the magazine format, we're going to have some new features. So obviously, when you find your book, that can be part of the new review section where we're going to review both myself and you. We're going to review something each month, so a little bit of an update on stuff as well. So yeah, I've been quite busy lately. I mean, I've been looking at new areas to do seances. I'm looking for. I've done a lot in Datchet and places around Windsor and stuff like that. But I was looking at Bray, which is quite near Windsor, and the weird thing about that is there's a lot of history there. It's a very old place, but it's quite spooky because they filmed a lot of the Hammer horror films around there.
Okay,
so you've got these buildings that look like Dracula's castle. There's the Oakley Court Hotel, it's called, and also you've got like these big open fields and stuff like that around there where they filmed a lot of the Frankenstein village. But it's a very old village, you know, and the history there is amazing. We found this church nearby. It's a very old church called the Church of St. Michael in Bray, and weird thing, it's got a thing, you know, there's they have like little carvings and stuff like that on there. There's a Sheila Gig there,
right,
on one of the columns in the church, and there's no story. I don't know how it appeared there or why it was there, cause it's so old. But basically what they described it as, they're not sure, right, whether it's a miserly figure holding a sack or it's like a demon, it's raising its garment to exhibit its sagging genitalia. Right, and so, you know, they appear in strange locations, usually where there's pagan sites, because it's associated with Irish mythology, going back to the fairy folk and stuff like that. But Sheena Gig is usually associated with Ireland, so to have one over in Berkshire at a church, it's very strange.
Isn't that a Smith song as well?
No, that was PJ Harvey.
PJ Harvey, that was it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I knew it was someone had done a song of that title, but
yeah, I don't know how I know that. I don't even like her music. You know.
I'm no, I don't.
Max Bygraves. But yeah, no, it's, yeah, she, so it was PJ Harvey, I think, yeah. But yeah, no, it's, we're going to look at Bray to do like a seance here. And it's quite an interesting history. So we see what sort of activity we get there. Because we do get a lot in Datchet, but I want to do a bit of variety and do some other places, you know. But it's hard to get in. But I have found a location which we can hire, which is like a hall nearby, so we can do a ghost walk around there and then do the Ouija boards back at the hall and stuff like that.
Brilliant.
So we're doing that. And the other thing, I mean, there's a man, I think he listens to the show, a friend of mine, his name's Mark Dillaway, he's an antiques dealer. And he sends me some odd things now in my museum, my collection. And he comes with some very good stuff that he has, you know what I mean, he sends across to me. And this month he sent me a really fantastic, it was some Victorian dentistry equipment.
Oh, very nice.
So that's quite nice, you know what I mean? So there's plenty of sort of teeth pulled out there with no anaesthetic, do you know what I mean? It's probably inflicted a lot of pain on people. Probably nearly as good as having Mad Frankie Fraser's pliers, isn't it? For the amount of pain they've caused and the
great the psychometry department. And getting people tuning into all the pain.
Definitely.
Don't let anyone get away with a toothache, though.
No, exactly, but you know, but yeah, well, can yank it out if they do need to.
Oh, so you've got the tools now.
Got the tools, now, so yeah. So if anybody needs dentistry cheap, you know, just contact us via, you know, by the Mystic Magic website, I can do that. But the other things working on, I mean, I've been working on some music lately, you know, as people listen to the show know, I've written the theme tune of the show. And I've had people request, some people commissioned me to write music for their shows, and also they've asked to use bits of music for their podcast, for their shows, you know. What I'm doing is I'm writing some pieces of music. They're like a minute long, you know, like introduction things, you know. And I'm going to put them for sale. So if people want to buy a theme tune for their own podcast or their own, you know, paranormal or mentalism show, whatever they're doing, they can buy that piece of music from me, and they own the rights to use it. No one else can use that, so they own that piece of music. So that's what I'm working on at the moment as well. So I've been quite busy with stuff.
And some of those bits on the show, you know, there's the new, you know, new intros to the sections of the show. Got those sat right in front of me now, ready to edit in later on.
Fabulous. Excellent. And we've got some good new sections coming up in the show. And we're going to be covering drones. We're going to be drones with Dan. We're going to be doing from
Dan's droning on.
Dan's drones, yeah. But we're going to look at what, you know, your adventures with drones and talk about, you know, drones themselves. And anyone's got stories themselves. They use a drone to get into a weird place. Or if there's anyone in America who's tried to go across Area 51 or, in, you know, or gone inside a haunted house and want to contact us, we'll feature that on the show. So anything there where people, drones have been used to investigate strange old buildings or paranormal, we're going to feature that on the show. So that's a new section. And also tortured artists as well, Dan, aren't we?
Oh, yes. Yeah, of course. You know, we're both artists ourselves, and we both have our little quirks. I would say I'm tortured to a certain degree, and the only way I kind of deal with that torture is by being creative. So we're going to be covering other artists, be it musicians, authors, painters, and we're going to just have a sort of a half hour sort of section, 20 to 30 minute section, covering the life of that person, their art, any strange stories associated with them, and some of them do have some very strange stories associated with them. So yeah, that's one. What's that? Are you sorting through some C90 cassettes there?
No, I wish I had some C90. Actually, I've got.
That sounds like going through a tape box.
Oh, I've got some tapes somewhere. Actually, I've got a book somewhere in the cupboard there, if I can find them. But I did have a big box of tapes from the 80s and 90s of music and stuff I recorded, and I managed to convert some of them to MP3. So I've got a sort of cassette thing. It's a Japanese cassette player which you connect to your computer and you play a cassette and it makes it to an MP3.
Yeah. I know what you mean. What was it then? Yeah. It's like Guess That Sound.
It was a CD.
Modern. Okay, that just goes to show, you see. The last time I sorted through anything like that, it would have been C90 cassettes. I kind of missed the whole CD thing. And and then straight onto digital stuff. So there you go.
I've probably got about 3,000 CDs.
Jeez.
And the thing is what is it? When you put them onto your iPod or your iPhone or whatever, right? My computer filled up so much of the music that I put on there that I had to buy a 2 terabyte external hard drive to store just the music alone. I had a stack there that was about to fall over, so I went over there and made sure it didn't fall over. I've got lots of CDs stacked around me, very rare ones as well, I've got, you know, and really weird stuff, because I like to collect really unusual music or something that's really strange. I used to search for the weirdest or unusual, most bizarre music that I could. So I've got a collection probably of the strangest music in the UK, I'd say.
So you spend some of your time then curating your bizarre collection of CDs.
Yeah, I've got some weird. I mean, some of the stuff that I've got some very weird music I've got hold of. You know, really obscure stuff. You know, like I say, one of them is an album we're going to feature on the show
next month.
Which is Charles Manson album. You know, the famous.
He's our first tortured artist.
First tortured artist. Yeah, and I've got really very strange. I've got one album with a bloke who lived. He was a tramp basically, but he lived under, you know, the Hollywood sign in America,
Los Angeles,
he lived under one of the L's, and he wandered about, and he's a hippie, barefoot, he lived under this sign, you know, mad as a hatter. But he wrote a song which Nat King Cole recorded called Nature Boy, which is all about himself being a man of nature. But then the record company said, we'll put you in the studio to do an album, and they thought they'd get all these songs which are going to be nice catchy songs. But it's basically this hippie, this is in the 50s, monologues about him living under the moon and stuff like that. And that's a really hard to get hold of albums, so I've got hold of that album. I've got loads of Moog synthesizer stuff from the 70s. You know, people these sort of rules of beep, 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 sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Loads of rare stuff. So I've got, some weirdest, probably got the weirdest collection of music ever, I think.
Excellent.
And, but it's to search down for stuff like that. You know, I've got one recorded by a patient from a paranoid schizophrenic who tried to kill his mother. They put him in a studio and made him record all these songs and that sort of stuff, you know. And I curate a lot of really strange stuff.
Cool. The degree I did was sound engineering, and as part of our actual dissertation, we had to actually produce, I think, about 8 tracks. We had to do 8 tracks, and I did one, which was just a soundscape. I actually got an orchestra in, just asked them to make as many spooky sounds as possible, and I dropped an old cassette of ghost stories over the top of it. And mix that down. So tell you what we'll probably do is I'll dig that out and we'll play that next after the after this section and before our interview with Michael Day, which is coming up straight after the Our Bizarre Life.
Yeah, first thing I was recall I did probably about 1990, where me and my friend we used to go to a spiritualist church, and we were invited to go and see this old lady. She's dead now, but she's about 98. And she lives in this really weird old house. It's like a proper, what you expect an old psychic living, you know, China teacups and stuff like that. And we was invited to go around there for a reading and meet this woman, Olive Tomlinson, her name was. And when we went around there, she was like, she'd change into your spirit guide. Like, she goes, I've got a Chinese man coming through. And she's like, oh, da-da, and her face would change. And she made like, like cucumber sandwiches with no crust. It's very old English. It's like Mrs. Marple kind of thing. But we recorded it. I had like a dictaphone at the time, and I recorded it. I thought I don't think we're allowed to, but I put this dictaphone there, recorded this reading. Mm-hmm. And what we did is we did a song where we had some music where we sampled her voice over the top, giving these readings and stuff like that, and doing this Chinese voice. And she sort of sang about be creative. You know, one person's rubbish is good for someone else. So if you're green creative, do what you think is right. Don't do things to other people. Do what you think is right. What she said.
Hmm.
And then she says, one person's rubbish is good for someone else. And so we made a song around this quotation that she came up with. So,
you have to dig that out as well.
Oh, I've got it somewhere. Yeah, it's quite funny. So, it's all good fun.
It is. So what we'll do is now we'll take a short break. I'll go and dig out my university dissertation project, or some of it, and we'll play that now. And then we'll be back after the break with a great interview with Michael Day.
From the corner of the room by the door, this uneasy silence was broken by a deep anguished sobbing. Such depth of anguish you'd never heard of. Nothing hysterical. These awful sobs came at seemingly measured intervals. They were from the depths of this poor creature's soul. Nothing could be seen. Yet the sobbing sounds moved nearer to the makeshift card table. The sound engulfed the whole room, and it was not loud. Alan could see the terror in his friends' faces as they followed the dreadful cries with the slightest turn to their gaze. Past the card table, they followed the sound. Past where only a few moments ago, they'd been happily sitting. Till it seemed odd, by the window. The movement had stopped, but the unearthly sobbing seemed to reach even greater depths of unearthly torment. The immortal soul of the creature was revealed in the desperation of those cries. The room was filled with the indescribable atmosphere that accompanies circumstances that reach beyond human understanding. Gradually the room seemed to light. Perhaps a patch of cloud had suddenly rolled away from the brilliance of the moonlight. But surely, slowly, the room was bathed in the pale, cold light of the October moon. Or was it? For the light seemed to emanate from the very source of the soul. Hardly daring to look, but entranced by the spell of those brief, sickening moments of fear, Alan became aware that this strange light was painting a recognizable shape. What looked like curtain drapes began to appear from the floor, up to a canopy that outlined the shape of an old bed. Distinct forms began to emerge, two heavily carved ghosts. Drapes all around, and there, sitting on the edge of the bed, was a young woman, long hair, and a face which rested in his hands, elbows supported by her knees. Her dress was white, and her body shook with a convulsion of such depth of anguish. What in the name of creation had caused this agonized despair? The three soldiers stood transfixed. Then Jake dropped the beer bottle he'd been clutching. Well, the sound seemed to give them in back the movement in their limbs. They rushed for the door, scrambled down the stairs to the basement canteen. There they met with not disbelief, as they'd expected, but by the shakily told story of two fire pickets who'd witnessed a similarly strange strangers. Well, these fire pickets had been patrolling the grounds as usual. When they heard the sound of angry voices in the lane outside, the voices were quite distinct. Door to the lane flew open. A young woman rushed headlong through. One of the patrol put out his arms to prevent what would have been a sure collision. The impact did not come. The impact did not come. The impact did not come.
Back to the Mystic Menagerie podcast, and we've got another fantastic interview with a very special guest today. On the show, we have the New Age leader and guru, Mr. Michael Day. Welcome to the show, Michael.
Hi, glad to be here.
Hi, Michael.
It's great to have you on the show, mate. And Michael, we're going to sort of cover, you know, what you're about, really, because, you know, we like to have interesting people with interesting lives on the show, and you're one of the most interesting people that I know. So I'd like to, you know, just recap about what you do. You know, you are a New Age leader, aren't you? You give people advice, you advise people. Do you know what I mean? You're a guru to many, aren't you?
Yes. Well, I've been doing all this for about 23 years. Yeah, before the era of Facebook and Skype and internet. So I started in 1993. I started in Peckham Market, would you believe it? Wow. And there we go. And from there, I progressed to the Brain Club, which was London's first New Age nightclub. And I was sitting in a corner doing tarot cards. And it was all very lovely. I had one client there who was, you know, quite impressed. And she said to me, why don't you come over to Barbados? Come for as long as you like. Of course, me being very naive, I booked 6 weeks. She was absolutely horrified. I turn up, I've got a 6-week ticket, and she's got to find me clients in her sort of, you know, new shop. There's nobody out there doing tarot or psychic readings or anything. But, you know, by the grace of all this, I had 6 weeks of clients, and that really got me set up in this business, because it really sort of tested me, and I got used to spirits in a different country, and it's very exotic out there in the Caribbean. So I've been going to Barbados for the last 20 odd years. I went recently, and it's always very exciting being there, because it's such a gorgeous place, and spirit flows through. So I'm mainly a psychic reader, tarot card reader, also I'm doing astrology, and these days I do a fair bit of life coaching, and life coaching really is a much easier way to make money. But yep. Spirit wants to still use me. I'm still doing lots of sessions and so on. But clearly, in the age of Skype and internet, you know, coaching is the future for a lot of people, and yep. so on.
Certainly is, and it's like it's on the internet. It's easy to get in touch with people and access people, isn't it, these days? So it does help when you know people know about you more. Like, you know, obviously going to Barbados was kind of like a fluke situation where you made your name over there, you got known, you've got a reputation there, and that's, these days it's easier to get connected with people overseas, isn't it, and stay in touch with them than it was then. So, you know, the internet, you're quite active on social media, aren't you, Michael? It's a good tool for you to promote yourself and to get things across, isn't it?
I've had some very interesting clients from Facebook and some very unusual blind dates, but we'll leave that one side. We're keeping it all a family show. So I've had some very interesting clients from here. And obviously there's a lot more people out there doing what I do, and that's all good. Because it was great to go to Barbados and be like first person out there and to start fresh and out there. You know, like 20 years ago, there's a lot more spirit activity, a lot more sort of black magic going on. These days, it's much more cleaned up now. They've turned the whole place into golf courses. But there's still some gorgeous energy out there in the Caribbean. And my guides love to be out there. I've also worked in New York and Miami. And that's also great. So it's great to travel. That's the one thing about this job. It's good to travel. Though now, thanks to Skype, I can just sit here and tune into people from, you know, California or France or, you know, Australia.
That's fantastic. So when you were in Barbados, what reason was the religion there? Would you say they were Christians, or would you say it was like a more of a witchcraft kind of vibe to it there?
Well, what it is, Barbados is a very much, you know, it's full of churches. Every street corner has got a church. But people want a lot more individual attention. Actually, a lot of people out there are having amazing spiritual experiences, and they look very like ordinary people, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Average, having incredible fifth dimensional experiences. They need help, they need a lot of support, and often people in the church can't really understand it. So people like me offer a good service because we're sort of neutral, we're objective, we're not judgmental, our job is not to put people down, not to try and change people, not to tell people off, just to work with them as they really are. Plus, in the old days, there were quite a few shamans out there, and Caribbean is all about love triangles, okay? Because the whole Caribbean culture is about having a mistress or two or three. It's all a bit controversial. And There's quite a few love spells going on and letters full of dirt arriving in the post. You get the picture, very basic love magic. And that was a big issue of people constantly, you know, caught up with love triangles. But even in the lovely pastures of Surbiton, where I do have a lot of clients, there's plenty of love triangles there, and that is a big part of my business. Sorting out these sort of love rat issues.
So you're a bit of a love guru as well, Michael, aren't you, as well, sorting this out?
Yeah.
A lot of readings are mostly, it seems to be the concern, as being a reader myself. People, you know, obviously career saying, but love seems to be the thing that people are most concerned about, isn't it? It seems to be the thing on most people's minds, that the primary concern they have.
Yeah. Well, I mean, love is basically, like, romance is how Western people find God these days, okay?
Because
we're all in little boxes. We're not really always having cosmic experiences, but everybody can fall in love, and everyone can have amazing sort of mystical sexual experiences. I'm sure you've had quite a few, Freddie.
Daily, on a daily basis, hourly basis.
Good, good. So it's how Western people find, you know, God, find the cosmic connection is through love and so on, and through unusual mystical sexual experiences. And yeah, I mean, I've heard loads of these over the years, you know. I mean, you'd be amazed how many people are having these transcendental sort of love magic situations. It's always fascinating to try and resolve them if you can. And it's not always easy because people get very high and then they tend to crash and burn. And also in the West, love tends to also bring up other issues like property rights, money. Divorce is the biggest way to transfer capital known. Okay, so that's why the wealthiest parts of the home counties tend to have the most divorce. You get what I'm saying here?
Yeah, exactly. Of course.
Yeah, because it's about if you've got the opportunity to become financially independent, suddenly your charming husband becomes very irritating.
Yeah, and suddenly the independence becomes more interesting, and then you can get half of that, you know. So you've dealt with some celebrity clients, haven't you, as well? I know maybe you can't name who they are, but there's a lot of celebrities come to you, don't they?
Well, I get quite a few actors and quite a few bit players on Casualty in Holby City. I can't really talk about people. I had a few interesting conversations with Amy Winehouse back in the day, but she's the one who got away, so I always feel a bit spooky seeing her picture around Camden, because obviously she still chose to exit at the age of 27.
Yeah.
You know, 27 is the favourite age for pop stars to make stage exit.
Yes, it certainly is. And she's very much a troubled soul. Did you find that when you spoke to her? Yeah, but did you find her to be a troubled soul, or did she just seem in control?
Well, both. It's both. And that's how it often is with these people who are, you know, maybe on substances. She was very, very intelligent, you know, very sharp, but she would turn on you for no reason.
Yeah.
And that's just because, you know, of her own psychology and so on. But lovely, gorgeous soul, and clearly a love addict, and, you know, don't say too much more, but obviously when someone dies, like when a client dies on you, it's quite shocking. But luckily, most are still alive. Most of them, people tend to live a long time these days, so you don't have too much of that going on.
Thankfully. But do you ever get a feeling when you're with her, that you feel that, oh, something's going to happen here, or she's on a path where something bad's going to happen? Did you sense that at all?
Well, again, this is controversial, but I was trying to warn her friend to do something. I felt she was hitting the edge, you know, how much can you tolerate before you totally lose the plot? So I felt that, and so I said something, but clearly in these cases the angel of death is very strong, and no one can really stop that. You know, when someone chooses that, it ends up like happening by timetable.
It could be the fact that she was here to fulfill a certain purpose, and she'd achieve that, and that's why she had to go. You know, maybe she's here to achieve. She achieved a lot in a very short space of time, didn't she?
Well, this is just my theory about life, is that some people find it very hard to receive large sums of money or to be seen as successful, okay? Because, you know, deep down, they're still living in the past definition of who they are.
Yeah.
Okay? So, like, she never really made that next album that would have made her very wealthy. Because she was, you know, she was wealthy enough, but she was sort of resisting the next stage. And often people in life tend to resist their own greatness.
Very true, very true. And I feel that she achieved what she needed to achieve. I mean, she could have gone on to greater heights, or even, you know, or maybe messed it up. You know, that's what I said. Maybe some of these people, like, you know, your Jim Morrison, Jimi Hendrix, they've done so much in a short space of time, more than a lot of people do in their whole lifetime. That they're kind of saying, okay, you know, you've done what you had to do, your time's up now. I think it should be that kind of...
It's what we call a sacrificial death or a martyrdom. Yeah, I do love the medieval view of life. Some people choose to be martyrs or to be sacrificial victims, like almost, you know, Jim Morrison, Jimi Hendrix, Amy. It's called the Club of 27. I call it the Year of Neptune. It's when a lot of pop stars choose to go and they become myths through an early death. They become legend. Yeah, you know, that same thing happened. The same thing happened to Jesus. Okay, you die young, you save the world. That's how it looks. Okay, so sort of medieval rites of passage. And in contrast, someone like Adele, who is like, you know, like the new Amy, she's going to be around for a long time because she's choosing life. Okay, so I think some of that old medieval mentality is starting to fade away, but it's still a temptation to crash and burn and become some kind of sacrificial object, a bit like Princess Diana also became a goddess through an early demise. But you know, these are supernatural theories because every actor, every pop star is like a spiritual object. It's to do with Neptune, it's to do with the energy of fame. They get a bigger aura from being famous, but also that they get a lot more pressure, and it's about coping with that. And it's to do with also beliefs around receiving. Is it okay to be famous? Is it okay to be wealthy? Yeah, I have a lot of clients, and they're great, they can sing, they can act, but they haven't got that complete belief that it's okay to be wealthy or it's okay to be famous. And as you know, most people don't make it, and they're often very talented. That 5% who make it, they've got that strong belief that they have a mission in the world and that it's okay to receive. And that is so important that with most of my clients, I work on their ability to receive. Because most people are good people. Most people, you know, do nice things, but they're often blocked about receiving their true worth.
And yes, it's true. And in your spirit, I mean, the number 27, has it got any significance in numerology? Is there something significant about that, or in the occult, would you say?
You can see something. I mean, it comes before the Saturn return, which is kind of like one's apotheosis at 28, 29. I say to people, 27 is a dream time. It's a Neptune time. It's when you're still searching for who you are. But you crystallize who you are at 28, 29. But 27, 2 and 7, 9, we can look at numbers. But it seems to be there's something about leaving the stage before you finally crystallized who you are in the world.
Fantastic. And Michael, when did you start on your spiritual path? What happened? As a child, did you have spiritual experience which made you become who you want to?
Well, let's just say I came from a very troubled sort of East End family. Still a bit dysfunctional, violent, alcoholic people. And at the age of 8, I found my kind of alternative life in the church. So I was at church 3 times a week, became a choir boy, learnt all the scriptures and catechism. I was really rising up the ranks in the church. And the age of 13, I sort of got a bit flaky and stopped that. But then at university, I formed my own mystic society and became quite a controversial figure on campus. In those days, it was all very strange. I was inviting gurus and teachers onto my campus and causing some concern. And I went to India, went to Stonehenge, free festival, found myself all the usual. And after graduation, I sort of explored Hinduism, Est, various transformational psychologies, learnt tarot. But I only saw it as a hobby. And then at the age of 33, everything changed in my life. And found myself in Barbados, dealing with issues of love triangles and black magic. What a turnaround.
Fantastic. What a career move, eh? That's a fantastic career move there. Did you have any spiritual experiences? Anything, like, you know, anything spooky or uncanny that happened to you, which made you really change your view on life?
I'll say I kept meeting people who were on the path having supernatural experiences who sort of draw me into that world. And I was always aware of being what I might call alien or alienated. And various psychics have seen sort of alien or reptile beings around me. It's all very fascinating.
Yeah.
And I've had all kinds of spiritual experiences. I've been, like, you know, a born-again Christian, had revelations, angels touching me. And again, these are all subjective experiences. But they meant a lot for me at the time.
As a choir boy, you sure it was angels touching you? Just to make sure.
Well, this was later on. Like, in my 20s, I got into very strong, charismatic groups. And, I felt angels around me. But these days, I feel that quite often anyway. And the angels are there just to keep you centered in the right path. And stop you getting too extreme. My guides, they just keep me fairly centered because they're quite keen to preserve me, so they stop me getting too outrageous.
And you're quite an outrageous character. I mean, your lifestyle, you tend to have a lot of fun. I mean, you live this sort of hippie dream a bit. You go around festivals, you really enjoy yourself in the summertime. You're almost like a nomadic presence that appears at festivals, aren't you?
Yes. Brilliant. Very interesting, because I sort of found out that, you know, you have to be in nature, you have to be around exuberant, colourful, optimistic people. You know, often these are younger people or their teachers of spirit who have that optimism in them. And often you find that at festival, this kind of whole alternative society. And the last few years I've been wearing my crown, my gold crown, and lots of people pay attention to that. And lots of people wear crowns now. But people still, like, bow down to me for no reason. And that means, like, a past life.
We had Arthur Pendragon on the show, on the last show.
Arthur, yeah, I've seen him around at Avery Stone's Circle. So he sort of claims to be, like, the king of the hippies. And I've met a few of those. And also, it's my ambition as well, but I'm only part-time. So,
talking to me about past lives, have you explored who you were in a previous life? Were you a king? Were you somebody who spread wisdom? And
let's just say that, see, the game is to get proof. I mean, you can have all kinds of visions, and everyone has their own vision, but the game is to get proof. And clearly, I'm obsessed with the era of King Charles I and the Civil War. And there's something there going on. And I keep meeting people who are descended from those people, even clients whose great ancestors were in the gunpowder plot, for example.
Right.
So, yeah, I keep meeting these people. So there's something about the English Civil War, Cavaliers, Roundheads, and even my mother, who's like the complete skeptic, like believes nothing at all, one day said, yes, she too was in the English Civil War. She was a Cavalier. Fascinating. That was a very bizarre thing to have my very atheist mother say such a thing. Mm. And also, I've got this issue with Jewish people. And the last 20 years, I've found that everywhere I go, parties, foreign beaches, New Age events, people who are quite psychic, they call me David. And right, that is my name. But it's been happening for 20 years. Everywhere I go, people say, hello, David. Good to see you again. But it's this weird version of me coming through. And that's only people who are quite tuned in. Yes. That.
So it's like an alter ego. People see you as another person, you know.
Well, it's sort of leaking through. It's sort of leaking through me. And I believe that, you know, it's a past life that's leaking through me, because clearly a part of me is this alchemist, and a part of me is very kind of mundane, East End chap. So it's kind of like this alchemical being in me is leeching through. It's a bit like being in the Matrix where you become somebody else. So it happens a lot, and clearly it's very hard to explain, and no one can explain it because it's a bit of a glitch in the Matrix. But I'm called David. Also, I have lots of doppelgangers around the world who seem to be kind of living an even better life than me, and they're often spotted in Ibiza and Copenhagen. But, you know, it's just like this. There are other versions of me walking about who are wealthier than me, go to more parties than me, are doing, you know, big stuff in this world of astrology. And they're like kind of future versions of me who are seen, spotted around the planet. Also, it's very hard to explain.
Yeah.
Quite a lot that people have seen me before in places where I've just arrived. And again, everything can be seen as coincidence, but after many years, it fits a pattern. That's how it is, isn't it? In a spiritual life, things start to make sense, but you can't quite prove it.
Certainly. So you reckon if I have a look for some medieval paintings, I'll see Michael Day there somewhere. Yeah, that's a possibility.
I'm sure you can. Yeah, I'm sure you can. I'm very interested in the medieval era, and it sort of fascinates me. And I do tend to meet people who kind of are living in this other world of, you might call it fantasy, people dressed as mermaids, unicorns. In fact, tonight I'm going to a dance walk with unicorns and so on. So they're all fascinating people. But these people are about elevating your third eye. So when you expand your third eye, you become a unicorn. You hang out with
them. Right.
This is what happens to people.
So that's what you see with them and what they actually are. You know, so they're taking a human form, but they are a mermaid or a fairy or a unicorn or something like that. But you're taking a human form. It's only when you're tuned in you can see it.
Yeah, but yeah, some people just now are living that life, and you go around dressed all the time as these people, and some people are just invisible. But many people see that I've got a fairly large third eye.
I suppose that's why some people are quite attracted to role-playing, you know, live role-playing, where they can dress up and be certain people or certain characters from different periods in time. And, you know, they might go away for the weekend and live, you know, on a medieval battlefield and or, as you know, in the trenches in World War II. It's almost like, I mean, do you believe in a way that souls are recycled? You know, once you die, is, you know, are we reincarnated, and do we always hold on to a bit of the past life as we move on?
Well, after 23 years of seeing people so many times, I have to admit that it's obvious to me that people really are living out past life episodes, and that things are leaking through. Clearly, some people are also living out patterns from ancestors, so that's where it's a bit controversial. Is it your bloodline that you're living out, or is it actually links into your own past lives? I think you can make a distinction. The past lives tend to influence one's spiritual and psychic pathways, whereas the bloodline ancestors tend to influence one's like core emotions and visceral experiences. So you can tell the difference. It can make it a bit complicated, but clearly I can see in my clients and in myself clues from other lifetimes. Like, I had one guy come to me. He's like the grandson of Carter, the guy who found Tutankhamun's tomb in the desert. And he's still having these constant nightmares about Tutankhamun and Egypt, you know, every other night. So these things get passed down, don't they?
They do, yeah.
They do, yeah.
Through generations, and it says in the Bible, you know, you pass on the sins to the third and fourth generations. So a lot of people are working out their money issues. It's linked into big dramatic episodes from their grandparents or great grandparents. And the spiritual stuff, I feel, comes from past lives. And it's about, you know, seeing, are there clear signs? Because clearly, as a reader, I try to stick to what I can prove in a session. I try to avoid speculation, but often there is clear evidence. I get visions of past lives, and the person says, yes, I've been fascinated my whole life with this particular culture or way of living. It's not proof, but it tends to add substance.
Yeah. I mean, just after Christmas, I had my I sent my DNA away to get my ancestry done and get my genome mapped and everything. And when it all came back, there was no real big surprise there, and I felt perfectly at home and comfortable with looking at my ancestry as if it was no surprise. It was almost as if I kind of knew it deep down anyway. There was no hidden kind of elements in there that I wasn't already aware of deep down, if you know what I mean. It was almost just confirming what I already knew in a strange way.
Yeah. So you feel quite at home in your bloodline.
Definitely, yeah. And, you know, having that confirmed in a more scientific sense explains a lot of the interests and things I've done in the past, which all revolve around that ancestry. So it kind of double confirms what you're saying and obviously matches it with the scientific side of DNA mapping as well.
Yes, because we're all living out a system. So people get a bit confused about why things happen. But often we're living out, like, our family system. It's called a family constellation. Mm. So we're compensating for, like, lost members of our family, or we're re-experiencing traumas from generations back, or we're compensating for brothers who have become, you know, maybe alcoholic, for example, in my case. So, right. And it goes a long way back. It can go back hundreds of years. Mm. And so we're all living out a family system, and also we're living out different spiritual beliefs, and we're living out our achievements from other lifetimes. This is why my basic belief is that people are very complex. I've been in this business 23 years. I've not met a boring person yet. Okay? Mm. Everyone's got a story. Everyone's complex. Clearly, you know, because of the media and so on, we're very keen to sort of put people into pigeonholes.
Yes.
But the surface, everyone's got a spooky story. Everyone's got something going on.
That's true. I mean, most people had a spiritual experience. Some people have a spiritual experience, but they don't acknowledge that. They try to make a rational sense of it. They don't accept it. They sort of say, oh yeah, it's just my imagination. You know, I think everybody has had some kind of experience of a spiritual nature or paranormal nature to some extent, which they kind of deny it. Do you think a lot of people are in denial of their spirituality? Do you think that's or is more of a shift towards people being more open these days?
Well, there's a lot more openness now, and what was seen as a bit crazy 30 years ago is now mainstream. I mean, everyone's doing yoga these days. So people are more open, but it's still a tendency to deny things. And a lot of people who drink too much are trying to sort of wash their spirit to dampen it down. It's just too much electricity in their system, for example. And a lot of people want to deny things that have happened because they're very keen to be focused on the material world. Now, and that's fine, because some people, their whole life is about material achievement, and anything paranormal might destabilize them. So I totally say, you know, if people want to be doing that, that's their truth. They, you know, people should not be disturbed. Some people need to be very focused to get a house together. They want to forget all their psychic or paranormal experiences. And some people really want to explore and to go on a vision quest. I mean, a lot of people now are, you know, doing ayahuasca and other things. So there's a new openness, and there's also a very kind of programmed fear from past generations about admitting one's magical nature. And so, you know, right now we're in a crossover where people are more open, but there's still a lot of people from past eras, past generations, who are very keen to control all this and keep it under wraps.
Yeah, definitely that way. Do you feel that aliens are amongst us? Do you feel that we've been visited by other people from another planet that are teaching people, maybe like in the past, or some cultures in the past have been more advanced than others? And do you feel there's some teachers from other planets that have come down here?
Well, I can only stick with my own kind of evidence. I mean, I used to go to quite a few alien cults when I was younger. People would claim to be alien teachers, and it's just some guy with a beard. But I have met unusual people. I met one girl at a nightclub who was extremely thin, had no fingerprints. You know, you meet these people, and there's evidence that some people are crossovers or hybrids. Clearly, some people have alien guides in their aura, and that can be spotted. And I hesitate to speculate beyond that, because there's a whole meta theory about root races and star systems. I tend to resonate with the star Sirius, which is really a planet of kind of spiritual orthodoxy and creating structure. That I was born on the day of Sirius rising over Egypt, July 23rd, and that is one of the most powerful days of the year. So I have definitely an energy link to Sirius. Most pop stars and shamans linked to the Pleiades and so on.
Excellent. One of your courses, you teach about people being successful as well, about finding the right path and how to be a success. Yeah, you're very good teaching people that, aren't you? How to make success themselves, or to emulate if there's someone around them that they want to pick up a vibe from. That being around successful people does generate success. That's one of the things you strongly believe, isn't it, Michael?
Well, listen, I have clients, and some of them are making a lot of money, and some of them are struggling just to get by. So I've observed these people, you know, over the years, and clearly everyone lives in their own world, and everyone's got a particular gift. Like, some people have the gift of love and romance, some people have the gift of wealth and manifestation, is what I call alchemy. So you can clearly learn these beliefs. I knew one guy who just used to read all these books about getting rich at 16, and he spent his whole life just accumulating money and houses and so on through the sheer power of self-belief that he deserves to have that money. Okay, and I've got many examples of that. And clearly, from my point of view, it's a third eye power, because the third eye is about vision and what you're creating, like, in the future. And if you can dissolve your past and magnetize your future through your third eye, anything is possible. Now, most people are sucked into their family beliefs. It's like, you don't want to become too rich in case that makes you disloyal to your family. Because a part of us wants to stay loyal to our family history. We can't earn more than our parents did. And that's where most people get stuck, is in all this emotional baggage and belief that the past has to be adhered to, that you can't leave your tribe. But a few radical individuals learn how to focus, to go forwards. Often they're keen to rebel against their family. Often they're not very intellectual, so they haven't got all these intellectual beliefs about life being difficult. And they just make a whole ton of money. And I would say, if that's your gift, I'm here to support you. You know, if your gift is having multiple lovers, I'm here to support that. It's not my job to judge which gift is correct.
Excellent. What's the strangest gift someone's had? Have you ever come across some of a really bizarre thing they wanted to do in life, or something they were drawn to, something really unusual, which you've had to advise them on, but you found it very difficult, or you felt maybe I shouldn't advise them on this?
Well, this is a famous issue. What do you do when your client claims to be Jesus and they sincerely believe it? What do you do about that? I've had a few of those.
A few, isn't it? Not just the one.
Well, there's quite a few. I mean, I've met quite a few people claiming to be Jesus, and the bizarre thing is they're utterly convincing. Like, every word they say makes sense. They can justify everything. They've read all the texts. They can prove that they're Jesus, apart from they haven't got all the superpowers, and you have to explain why they haven't got that stuff going on yet. But they're very convincing, have lots of followers. I mean, there's plenty out there, and they're very charismatic people. I met one guy in Barbados who fully believed that he was Jesus. He came to me wanting advice how to spread his mission, and I told him to start a page on Facebook, and he was very happy with that advice.
And has he done well so far?
I'm not quite sure what he's doing, but clearly, you know, he's there in the Caribbean being Jesus, and, you know, there's so many of these people out there, and they're all doing what they do, and some of them get a few followers. And, I mean, clearly also I have many people who are having issues with what I might call polyamorous gurus or sect leaders. And they come to me very nonplussed. How come this guy is so unfaithful? And they haven't even read the beliefs of the sect that they belong to, which is clearly, you know, preaching polyamory and having multiple partners. And they are still puzzled by it. So a lot of people are in denial of what's going on.
Yeah.
And they complain about all these different groups and teachers, but they've signed up to it. You, what do you expect?
Mm. Yeah, definitely. I mean, if you're someone come to you and they say, look, this is my destiny, but it's something really horrible, you know. I mean, say, like, I mean, obviously Hitler, yeah, someone like that, he thought he had his own destiny, or you know, or Yorkshire Ripper. They said, well, this is what my mission is to do. How would you dissuade them? Would you dissuade them? Would you feel it's right to dissuade them? And if he felt it was wrong, would you feel, well, that's their destiny? Or would you feel, well, no, I've got to dissuade them from this because it's bad?
You see, this is where it gets very controversial. Like, I mean, I've had murderers come to see me. It gets controversial because obviously each person has their own world, and people have great evidence for their beliefs. I mean, if you read what Hitler wrote, it's very coherent. You start to believe it. All these people have very powerful belief systems that can suck you in. So these people are just going to follow their pathway to the bitter end, and they may drag people down with them. But, you know, often it's their destiny to be what we might call dark angels. And dark angels also help to enlighten people. Like, people talk about soulmates, but they're not aware that there's also light soulmates and dark soulmates. And you can meet your dark soulmate and be totally in love with that person, and that person will destroy you, but you'll learn so much through the process. You see, so how do we stop people? I think it's very hard to stop people. And clearly, it's best to be objective and neutral, because if you start trying to judge people, they will tend to walk away and leave you and not come back.
Yeah, so they're there to teach the lesson. So someone like Hitler was there to teach the world a lesson about evil, about power, really.
Yeah, I mean, he took power to the ultimate level, and his beliefs were profoundly spiritual. He started his own kind of religion based upon sun worship. I mean, there's a guy who fully believed in everything that he was talking about, and he convinced a lot of people to go his way. Why, in the end, you see, you have to have a certain level of rational discernment, because there's so many beliefs out there. There's thousands of different belief systems. Some of them will encourage you to start, you know, bombing your local tube station, for example. So my job is to be a neutral place, advise people what to believe, but you can't tell anyone in the end, you know, because they will walk away from you if you become judgmental.
Yeah, I mean, it's a tough one, isn't it? You know, I mean, it's the moral compass you've got yourself, but also people, if someone's belief is so strong, that is their reality, that is what they believe in. You know, like you say, you've had murderers come to you, and obviously these people like this, you know, their beliefs are very strong, what they feel they were doing was justified.
Oh, yeah. I mean, my murderer was, you know, very clear what happened, why he was justified. And now he's a very spiritual person. And, you know, also, I've met people who are, you know, working with black magic, but in their mind, they're doing good.
Yes.
If you hang out with corporate people, they all think they're doing good for the planet. I mean, I've worked for oil companies. The people there think they're doing God's work. So everyone's got their own point of view. Why don't you try and, you know, cross boundaries and try and persuade people of their wrongdoing? It gets very messy. You know, there can be a lot of mental and physical violence if you start to try and interrupt people's beliefs.
Definitely. Who's the most difficult client you've had? You had somebody who's been very, very difficult, or very, you know, just trying to go against everything. You know, there's someone who's been very, a real handful to deal with, because we always get them, don't we?
Well, you know, every client has their challenge, and in the end, it's about, you know, persevering. Because I've had some clients come to me for years who have been depressed for years and years and years, and they keep coming back. And they're very depressed. One client came to see for, like, you know, 20 years, and she finally got a boyfriend, and now she's happy.
Yeah. So something missing in her life. That's what she needed, is that last piece of the jigsaw to put things back as they were.
But it takes some people years and years to get out of a mental pit. That's why time and space don't matter. You know, some people take years to achieve one thing. Some start manifesting soulmates after one session. You know, you get those great sort of testimonials. I met my soulmate after one session. But it's also other people who take, you know, decades to achieve anything, and that for them is their life path.
Exactly. Yeah. But no, it's an interesting subject, and the human race, like you say, is a very interesting thing altogether. You know, I've come across people before myself, people who believe they were vampires or believe they were werewolves, that kind of thing. You know, and they're very convincing.
Yes, I met those people, and they are, I believe, changelings. Some people are manifesting both light and dark gifts from spirit, and some people are heading towards becoming werewolves. I had one client complain about her boyfriend every full moon. He'd start growling and sitting in the corner. So these things are happening out there. You know, in the back streets of Highgate or suburban Australia, all these things are going on behind closed doors. And because my job is to be neutral, not to judge, clearly I get to meet these people because I'm like a safe space, so I'll be telling them what to do. So
yeah.
People who are changing, because a lot of people are now becoming fourth and fifth dimensional. And what does that mean? Well, it means that you're perceiving different space-time sequences. You're perceiving different worlds. And yet you're still in this world, but you're aware of different parallel universes operating next to you. You're aware of higher realms. And clearly, if it all goes pear-shaped, you end up being diagnosed as schizophrenic.
What?
You know, it can be awkward. I met one guy who claimed to be Jesus, and he was sort of wearing a dress, so it's the first ever transvestite Jesus. Fascinating. So you meet these characters, but obviously my job is to say it's okay to have spiritual experiences, you're not crazy.
Okay? Yeah.
And most people, even if they have episodes of losing control, being dysfunctional, with a bit of patience and a bit of love, they can come back to being centered. They don't have to be locked up. It just requires a bit of time and patience. People will come back and start functioning.
So spiritually, in the occult, who would you say were your role models or heroes? Who are the people that you've learned a lot from, or people from history, or could be present time, people you looked at and thought, you know, they're a good inspiration to me?
Well, two things. First of all, like when I was young, they had all this great TV for kids full of, there's something called Ace of Wands, which
is
probably about magician. That changed my life, because there was a guy who was magical and sexy and charismatic. I thought, I want to be him.
His name's Tarot, wasn't it? Is it Tarot, I think? Yeah, I remember that very well.
Yes, Tarot Man, Tarot Phenomena, Tarot Man, the Mystic Man. I thought, that is what I want to do, and I grow up. And look, it all happened.
You succeeded.
Yeah, it happened. So
you've done it.
This TV was decent in those days. It actually changed people. something called the Owl Service. Yeah, they're really good mystical TV in the 60s.
It was, yeah.
Amazing. Also, I've always been a big fan of Nostradamus, the great prophet from France. And one day I just answered a random leaflet and I ended up on this big Channel 4 documentary about Nostradamus. And
excellent.
I got to read out these big like prophecies from Nostradamus's famous quatrains on primetime TV. And that was a life-changing event, you know, because the picture of me next to Nostradamus, and there I was becoming like son of Nostradamus. Wow. And also that night, they put on this show saying tonight is the end of the world. And people started to believe it. People were like phoning in saying, help, help, is it really the end of the world? So it's a lovely bit of mass hysteria thanks to Channel 4. But that was a big influence on me. And after that, some people loved me and some people hated me because clearly I went with the whole trip. But I think it's great to be on TV and to be seen. And TV does change you. I've been on lottery shows and daytime TV, but hey, these things come and go. It's not
definitely,
real.
Yeah. Excellent. Can people find us online? The you Nostradamus show, is that online on YouTube or not this?
It could be online somewhere, yes. It's called The Real Nostradamus, and I think it's by Tiger Aspect, and it's somewhere in the back catalogue of Channel 4 somewhere.
We'll have to track it down and put it on our blog so people can see you in action, Michael.
Yes, well, it's a great show. It's a great show.
I first met you when you were working with the lovely Kate McKenzie and the Love Fairies. I mean, people listening to the show may not know Kate or may not know the Love Fairies, but, you know, just let people know what that's all about.
Well, Love Fairies is another mystic tribe of, you know, fifth-dimensional people. And Kate McKenzie is like a love guru, and she's often on TV these days, and she's pure love, and she created the Love Fairies to go on stage at Mind Body Spirit Festival, and we just prance about and we go out and hug people and be generally very fairy like and we just sort of wear wings and have magic wands. And I mean, it's great to be part of a fairy tribe. In fact, tonight I'm putting on my wings again to go dance walking with the unicorns around Covent Garden. So that's going to be lovely. And Love Fairies ended up performing at cabarets around London. I think they appeared in your cabaret a few times.
That's right, many times, yeah.
But of course, fairies are now big business. There's fairy conventions across England, in Cornwall, in Glastonbury. It's now a big business. That's started in the last, like, you know, 15 years. Now, fairies are a big commercial thing. Now, unicorns are getting on mainstream TV and like, you know, going live and becoming a whole worldwide thing. So now you see the game is to invoke these fifth-dimensional beings into your life, to dress up. And now everyone now loves dressing up and going to parties and being outrageous. You know, it's the fashion now, isn't it? Because people want to bring in that fifth dimensional energy, because after a day of staring at a PC or Mac, you want to get out there and live out your fantasy life.
And that's probably why things like superheroes are so popular these days, because people have these other identities, other dimension, like escapism, another character. Totally. They don't have to be themselves.
Well, I think the modern era is very good in terms of people now have opportunities to really live out these supernatural states. And clearly some people can get a bit ungrounded in the modern world, but there's also a lot of time and opportunity to really live out these different spiritual fantasy figures and to be Superman or to be a vampire and so on. They're just playing out different roles from the unconscious. And also, we're working out all our medieval anxieties. It's like, you know, Halloween is a way of letting go of tension by almost making fun of spiritual terror. So all these things, whether light or dark, they're here to act out the unconscious, and it makes people more free, and I welcome that. People need to live out their fantasies. And some people really are in a fifth dimensional state and are here to bring healing to others. And also, I do recommend, of course, traveling to powerful places around the world. Ibiza is a real magnetic spot. Copanyan is pure crystal, very much a goddess island. All the ley lines around Glastonbury do really exist. So if we go to power points, we'll feel these supernatural energies coming in, and that is, you know, to be welcomed.
Yeah, definitely. What's the place you felt the most energy? You've been there and you thought, wow, there's so much energy here. Which place on earth would you say you've been to?
Well, I've just been to Copanyan. There's quite a lot of love energy going on there. But I think Barbados is a really powerful place. There's a lot of African energy there. But it's also a lot of beautiful crystal Atlantis energy around Barbados. I would hesitate to go to other islands because that would be a bit more dangerous.
Yeah. But
there's a lot of fifth dimensional beauty and good protection in Barbados. So it's a powerful place. You feel like the spirits of the slaves. You feel the plantation owners. And I've been to, you know, powerful haunted houses in Barbados, and often the royal family love to go to the same places because the royals love everything supernatural.
Yes,
there's a lot of power to be, and once you get over that sort of nervousness, it's good to go to where spirit is happening. You can really tap into that energy. And I have some clients who work with the royal family, and clearly they're all great spiritual people. I've met Prince Charles once, or actually twice, but the second time Prince Charles came up to me at a party and said, do you want to live in my monastery in Mount Athos?
Wow.
He was checking out my aura from across the room, tweaked who I was on some supernatural level, and asked me to join his Greek monastery. Look, it's only guys hanging out there, so it might be a bit of a drag. But anyway, Prince Charles is a powerful supernatural being, and I really love everything he does and says.
Fantastic. So, and when you go to Barbados, I bet you the first time you went there, when you was on the plane, you sang that song to yourself, didn't you? Well, I'm going to Barbados.
Yes, Coconut Airways.
Yes, you must sing that song. How could you not? You'd have to.
I was totally singing that song on the way, and it's a great place. I went there in 1993. There was virtually no clairvoyance there at all. It was just me, and you know, the whole New Age thing was just starting out there. And I mean, now everyone's got a health spa or a retreat center, but in those days, it was quite new. And
like myself and Dan, our household names in Japan. Yeah, your household name in Barbados. You're there, Russell Grant over there, I'd assume.
Yes. Well, many people think that I am Russell Grant. Once I went to a pub in Brighton, and he kept buying me drinks all night because they're convinced that I really was Russell Grant, and I get them on TV. And I'm talking about I said at 5 a.m, I'm not really Russell Grant, but thanks for all the beers. They were a bit let down.
Brilliant. Michael, of course, you've got a website, haven't you? So if anybody is just to show want to find out more about you, let them know your website.
Yeah, I'm on source.tv/Michael Day, and there's a great little summary of what I do, and or you can just email me direct, tarotmike@yahoo.com. I do life coaching, psychic readings, astrology, till the cows come home. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Excellent.
Michael, thanks for coming on the show. You've been a fantastic guest and a great interviewee, of course. There's lots of amazing stories, amazing man, amazing wife. Thank you for coming on the show, Mike. We really appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
I've always believed that there were several planes of existence, and we as human beings inhabit only one.
What happened to you guys last night anyway?
I was attacked.
Is this the first time something like this has ever happened?
No. Things have come to me. In the night.
Why do I see and feel these things?
Some things are more terrible than other things. And you felt like a man?
Big man. But when my son came in, there was nobody there. He evaporated.
Mysteries from the files of Nathan Sarea. Therapist, Shedi Knight and visionary, dabbler in Volkswagen engines and the occult, and now in retreat in a shed in North Wales, the Oracle ponders the riddles of this and other worlds.
Hello and welcome back to the Mystic Menagerie podcast. Now it's our regular feature, the Fortean Oracle, with the Oracle himself, Mr. Nathan Sarea. Hi there, Nathan.
Hiya, hi Dan, how you doing? How, Freddie?
We're all good. Yeah, the subject that we thought we'd spring on you in this show is one that cropped up on the internet last week, actually, and I sent it out via Facebook to you all. It's about two girls who claim to have regular sex with ghosts. So we'll talk about erotic entities and obviously experiences, and also famous cases, obviously, like The Entity. Anyone who grew up in the 80s, The Entity was probably one of the top horror films at the time, and with it being based on a true story, I found it particularly scary, and I still find it quite an eerie film to this day. Let's throw it out there. Erotic entities.
Of course
Sexy spirits. pervy poltergeists. anything else? I can't think of any more, but yeah.
There's got to be another one, isn't
it? Yeah, well, this article, I think Freddie actually put it out first, didn't you? You found it.
Yeah, I did put in a blog. Saucy Spectres, that's one. Saucy Spectres,
yeah.
Saucy Spectres.
Like Phil, not Phil, not Phil. Saucy Spectres. But yeah, I found that article. It came up on the Metro. You know, they have some. Metro's quite interesting. It has some really banal stories, and then it has some really oddball ones that come up now and then. Good ones. And it was on the Metro, and the basis of the headline was pretty great. It was, we tried to have sex with ghosts, and here's what happened. These two women who had sex with ghosts. Yeah.
I did read it. I think they were a little bit unsuccessful, so it may mean that they're just going about it the wrong way, or they're just not the type for the spirit world. You know, maybe they were using the wrong sort of psychic perfume or something. Or
is that a picture of them? The listeners can't see it, but is that them? Is that them there? Those two
that's
girls.
Them. That's them. Yes.
They look fucking miserable, don't they? Put it this way.
If you're a ghost.
If I saw them in a nightclub, I just wouldn't go up and talk to them because they look the least fun ever.
Yeah, so that may be what... Maybe they resonate that, you see, and ghosts are attracted to your sexy aura. They may have just been, you know, not that fussed. Or they might be busy around someone else's house. They might have all been watching Michael Jackson with that chimp.
Well, where do you draw the line with necrophilia as well? Because a ghost is a spirit of... essentially dead, isn't it? So it's almost invisible necrophilia.
Yeah, from my own personal, you know, moral compass or spiritual compass, I'd say to the listeners, do not try this at home. It is something which end up in a very unpleasant entity attachment scenario, or worse.
Word, especially if he, you know, gets stuck or just doesn't want to let go.
Well, the funny thing is, they've given guidelines on this, how to seduce a ghost, like a guidebook. So it's basically like a, you know, like a Kama Sutra, spiritual Kama Sutra. And there's only really five guidelines, and then there's steps. The guidelines are, one, know that it's real. Take it seriously. Be as goofy as you want. Have tons of fun. But know that you really are inviting a real spirit from beyond in. I assume in to themselves. And you're opening a real portal into our realms. So if you open a portal, they mean a portal. What sort of portal are they talking about? Within themselves?
You mean like arse clamps or something?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah, an arse or vagina portal. Would that become a portal where the spirits coming out from between their legs, right at their backside for a
It'd be like the wardrobe in Poltergeist. You know that one?
Yeah.
Yeah, where it's all like pink and slimy with all those teeth going down into like infinity with tentacles coming out.
You don't want an anal portal, do you, like that, do you? Do you know what I mean? I mean, you know...
an anal portal.
I think they're all
a punk band, isn't it?
I bet S. Rob could create a portal out of an anus.
We'll ask him, actually. We'll get him on the show soon and ask him if he can create an anal portal. Well, anal portal is a good name for... If anyone's thinking of forming a punk band, they can use that name, anal portal.
Anal portal. It's the right shape. It's like a miniature brown stargate.
Well, what if she opens up two portals? One at the front, one at the back. And there was ghosts coming out... at every orifice.
Well, they could march into one and appear out of the other. It's like a quick change routine.
Could be, yeah. It could be like in one way's in, one the other way's out. Like it is anyway, I suppose. Things go in one hole and out the other.
Yeah. What's the second one? Know your belief system. God, your angels, your guides. It doesn't matter. Your cat, even. It says your cat. It doesn't matter. Obviously not Shaggy Cat, but if your belief system is your cat, then you want to get you want to get yourself a boyfriend in a real life, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, there is an religion I said before, it's the only where they worship bees, so they produce honey, which is like the food of life. And people do worship animals. You know, I mean, Egyptians worship cats, you know, look up to them. Tips again, you can have an animal spirit guide. Mr. Shifter from the PG Tips, or the one that's all the France there. Can you ride tandem? That could be your spirit guide. Any animal could be, you know. So they're right. So know your higher self. So you're not really giving any real guidelines here as such. It's not any informative. Number three is don't get scared. Fear will do two negative things. It will prevent it from happening altogether. Fear will bring in the wrong kind of energy, a dark energy that will feed on your fear. That's a bit racist. And editor's note, So that's, basically you've got to be positive and strong energy. You don't want any dark energies there. You know, it's kind of like if you're scared, then you invite negativity in. What would you say about that, Nathan? Would you say if you're scared or something, you invite negativity? You go into a nightclub even and you'll look scared. Well, the negative people come over to you and pick you out as the weakest.
I think if you're giving it out, you're definitely going to attract it, yeah. If you're giving off that sort of thing in your aura, you know, it definitely tends to attract negative experiences of any kind. So, plus, if you're, you know, vibrating at a sort of level of any kind of fear, your aura tends to contract very much far closer to you. I would say perhaps you're in danger of unpleasant things getting, you know, more in proximity to you. At least people I know that, you know, when they get into difficult mental states or suffering from substance misuse issues or have traumas or surgeries, that is a time when entity attachment can actually happen. It's more common at those times. Yeah.
You're opening yourself up for a psychic backlash if you're scared. It's almost like a lion preying on the weaker animals on the plane. So I've always remembered this when I've been in like dodgy areas in the forces. If you ever get stranded on your own and you walk through the shittiest part of town, like hugging the buildings and hiding in the shadows and looking really scared, the chances are you're going to get picked on.
If you
walk along normally, head held high, chest out, walking with some confidence, people are more likely just to leave you alone because you belong in that environment or that certain air of confidence just puts them off. So I would assume the same things happen in the spirit world. If you're
definitely,
things are going to attach onto you if you're looking weak and vulnerable.
Saying it's like Dan was saying, if you're confident and you strut down the street, people leave you alone. And I think that's in life. If you look like you know what you're doing, people will leave you alone and assume you do know what you're doing, no matter what you're doing. If you're a mechanic, surgeon, whatever you're doing, if you look like, don't worry, I can sort this out, and you're confident, people will accept that, I think. Spirits included.
Yeah, unless you're Nigerian, and people think, fucking hell, he ain't got a clue what he's doing.
Exactly, yeah.
especially if it's like a doctor, or someone who has lots of certificates stuck on the wall from unknown universities.
Printed off the internet.
No word of a lie, I went to see my GP, and they had a Nigerian doctor in there, right? And I told him what was wrong with me, and he was typing on his computer, and I had a look round, and guess what he was doing?
What?
He was
playing Pac-Man.
He was fucking Googling what was up with me.
Some do that.
Not a word of a lie.
Doctor. Yeah, they do that. My missus was a different doctor from me a while ago, and it's like, hello, come in, this doctor. And everything she said, he was Googling, not even like a special medical search site. He was looking at Google, and I said, hang on, mate, we could go home and do that ourselves. You're being paid God knows how much to do this and wasting our time. If you're just Googling it, and if you Google anything, it just says you've got cancer anyway. So, and change doctors after that. I said to change the doctor, go to the one I go to. But, it's very dodgy. But it's funny, there's sort of funny doctors. I was just recently to doctors. There's a new doctor there. He's like a character from Mind Your Language, or like a, like Peter Sellers, The Party.
Yeah.
So come in, sit down. And he had all these toy monkeys on a shelf. And then he goes, I can't keep them on the floor, health and safety, but the kids can look at them, they can't play with them. But he's one of those doctors, if you go in there feeling pretty okay, you go out thinking you're going to die. Because I said to him about the acid reflux I get, when I get this acid when I have too much caffeine or something, it really hurts now. And I said, can I have some more tablets? He goes, you want to have a proper scan? He said, something stuck down your throat. I said, I'm going to fuck about like that, mate. He goes, the good thing is you get acid reflux, it's probably something else causing it, like cancer. I thought, you can't. And I left, and he goes, I'll give you the tablets now. He goes, but if you get it again, you better have that done. It's probably cancer or something like that. I thought, I went in there, we wanted some tablets to eat some acid, and I went out thinking I was going to die of cancer.
Yeah, he went out for some Gaviscon and he came out with 3 months to live.
You don't bandy the C word around like liberally, do you? Jesus Christ.
It's weird. He's telling me about how much he had, what he had for lunch, and how he cut the crust off of sandwiches and didn't like crust, and he used to go running and all the stuff that he did. He used to talk to animals when he was going for a run down the park, talk to squirrels and stuff. He was mental. And I thought, he should be a doctor. It's like they've got... It reminded me of that film, the Amicus film, Asylum, where the patients have actually taken over and they're the doctors.
Yeah.
It reminded me of that. Like the lunatic's taken over the asylum, like he's a lunatic, and he actually became the doctor, blagged his way in there somehow. Very scary it was. Mm. I went out there completely paranoid.
Yeah.
That wouldn't be a good experience, would it? That's not going to set your mind at rest at all.
It wasn't.
Slight medical tangent there, we'll come back full circle.
Yeah.
And step number four on the guideline to having sex with ghosts. Know that this is our realm of existence. They have to play by our rules.
Mm.
So you have the power, only if you give it to them. That's
so it's a bit of an S&M kind of thing, isn't it? It's a bit.
Yeah.
50 shades of.
This is my dungeon.
Exoplasm.
I'm in charge. Yeah. Get the gimp board in your mouth. Yeah, it's very, very strange. And last of all, have fun with it. Go with any let go of any preconceptions of it being evil or bad. Keep it good, healthy, and fun. Well, can you catch anything off a ghost?
Is there such thing as, STD, spiritually transmitted disease?
I suppose all ghosts must go bareback. There's only one way to do it, isn't there?
Exactly. But I mean, in the afterlife, can ghosts still carry diseases? I don't know anyone catch a disease of a ghost. I've never heard of that before.
It's, like plague vixen ghosts here,
and you don't.
Possession's pretty nasty, I've heard. But
I suppose it is. Yeah.
Yeah, but anything that gets attached to you is then affecting your template, isn't it? So if that, this corporate spirit. Had some sort of traumatic death, or it had a particular disease. If it's mapped into your body, mapped into your kind of auric space, then its vibration could begin affecting your vibration, a bit like by osmosis, energetically, if you like. So it could, the resonance of it could actually begin to affect you as a person. And I have seen things like this where someone's been affected in a particular way physically, and it's because the entity that was attached to them had died from that particular disorder in the past, or so this entity disclosed.
When it triggered the same symptoms in the person.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so that does make sense.
If something's going to get attached to you, it's going to get attached to you because it wants something from you. It wants to feed from you. It wants to feed from the people around you, or it wants to create dramas. It wants to create trouble so it can feed off the emotional kind of nectar, if you like, of the negative emotions.
Yeah.
So, and some things are just lost, so they find a safe haven, which is a willing kind of other person's space, but they do seem to have a great effect on us. There's a really, really a great book that I first got into when I was working on this subject first many years ago, and it was a lady called Edith Fiori, and she wrote a book called The Unquiet Dead, which was the first sort of treatise on working with entity attachment therapeutically, because she was a psychotherapist. And she began to find that some of her clients were struggling with these disorders that she could not identify a logical root cause to them. And after a few sort of selective sessions, stuff started coming out, and these entities began identifying themselves as separate from the clients, but inside the clients, if you like, inside their mind and their body field. So very interesting work. Really, really interesting. One of those books you just go, oh my God, read it cover to cover, in a matter of days. But that was the first sort of really good work on it, The Unquiet Dead. So they did give that is a really, really real thing. So when people sort of do a lot of these, haunted tours, or you get a few of the sort of like cowboy people that are just, like, for example, people that want to go to that North Wales Hospital, that Denby Asylum. That place is such a powerful place, but people have said that they feel such absolute evil in there, and quite rightly, because mental hospitals and all the kinds of entities to be attached to people's madness and disorientation and pain and suffering, that would potentially attract some really, really dark stuff.
And the treatments they had, the lobotomies Victorian medicine,
torture.
And all the abuse that went on there as well,
Humans
being humans, there'd be a lot of sexual abuse and stuff going on in an institute like that. You can just guarantee it without a doubt.
Oh, big time. Like I said before, that Cane Hill was among the most sinister, scary, horrible places I've been in. The feeling of, suffocation in there, the feeling of despair, the horrible, it just felt horrible in there. I couldn't even stay there for very long.
I mean, one of the scariest places you could probably do a seance nowadays and open yourself up to this, like, seduction of a ghost would be Jimmy Savile's apartment.
Yeah. It'd do one there, yeah.
But you can imagine, it is he is Britain's most prolific evil...
Nonce,
at the end of the day. Yeah. So, and I've got no doubt that in the afterlife, if there is such a thing, he was so prolific and so evil that wanting to do things like that is still there. It doesn't
still resist it.
If you can open yourself up to this kind of having sex with ghosts, in my eyes, the entities that are going to be queuing up to interact with people are going to be those types of spirits.
They're not going to be the good ones.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not going to be like the old lady from down the road, is it? Who fancies a bit of slap and tickle. It's going to be some horrific sex pest who died.
Marilyn Monroe, she's a bit of a go, and she's Marilyn Monroe, she'd be up for it.
Well, that wouldn't be so bad. But
Freddie Mercury, Freddie Mercury would be up for anything, wouldn't he? I think
he would.
Jimmy Savile, Jay Savile, they're the ones that I sense that you would attract. Do you know what the name is? There's some people that are sexually attracted to ghosts. There's actually a medical term for it. Do you know what it's called?
Go on.
Spectrophilia. It's in the Wikipedia page. It's a sexual attraction to ghosts or sexual arousal from images in mirrors, as well as the phenomenon of sexual encounters between ghosts and humans. It's a fetish, apparently. And it mentions about it in folklore. There's many folklore I have spirits having sexual relations with humans, including Arabic, Greek, Hindu, and Celtic culture.
Yeah, I mean, it goes back to the dawn of time, doesn't it? Sex with spirits.
I tell you what, I don't remember this, though, because you said about the Entity, 1981 film, the Entity, but also, apparently, in one scene in the popular film Ghostbusters, the character Ray, played by Dan Aykroyd, has a dream in which he receives fellatio from a ghost. Do you remember that?
Yes, yeah, I remember that. His fly comes down, he's lying on the bed, his fly...
Ghostbusters?
Yeah, that is in Ghostbusters. His fly goes down on its own.
No.
Yeah, and then he does the old police academy, ooh, you know, his eyes rolling type thing. So yeah, that he gets a chew on Ghostbusters.
Oh, I don't remember that scene at all. That's the version I had was edited.
Did you have that, the version on the DVD which says theatrical version, then it's got like the unrated version? Which
no, because I didn't think it was there. I didn't think it was there either, because I listened to a podcast on Ghostbusters and all the hidden bits and bobs and Easter eggs in it. And for saying it was a PG, someone says, oh yeah, Ray Stantz. They say, yeah, his fly goes down and he gets a blowjob from a ghost. And it is there. You can go on Ghostbusters and you can watch that bit right now. But you won't have noticed it, because when you watched it, you were probably too innocent to know what it was.
Exactly. And now, Benny Hill years later, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like, oh, there you go, hold on a minute.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, yeah, going back to the entity, do you want to hear my very, very strange entity story? It is, one which involves a rather disconcerting set of experiences. When I first moved into this house, 2001, it was when I came back from traveling in America, and I was starting to teach a series of like, you know, courses working with advanced hypnotherapeutic techniques and entity attachment and you know, spirit removal and that sort of thing. My little brother came over one weekend, and he just he knocked on the door and came in. He said, oh, you've something's dropped out behind your car. You must have dropped this film out of your boot when you got trying to bring stuff into the house. And I've been having very strange experiences just in the main bedroom here. When I first got here, it was the last room that I ever decorated, but I'd never slept well in there. And then I started to get this feeling of being attacked in my sleep. And this sort of peaked to the point where something grabbed me and tried to asphyxiate me. And then something actually knocked me right across the bed, physically hit me so hard it knocked me across the bed, you know, from like left to right. And he came in with the entity in his hand, the film. And I just looked at him and I went, that's not mine. He goes, well, it was under the back wheel of your car, outside on the street. And I was like, you know, you just think, where the fucking hell did that come from? Because it was either, where did it come from? Did someone put it there who formerly lived in this house and was trying to tell me something? Or... you know, when something just doesn't make any sense, but it was, he said, it was literally underneath the back wheel that was up against the curb, and it was clearly either meant for me to find it or it had dropped out the back of the car. Now, there was nothing else around, so what was that all about? And obviously, I'd seen trailers for the entity many years ago, and obviously I thought it was quite disturbing. But when I actually watched the film, you know, when you just sit there and your mouth falls open, you go, oh, shit.
Yeah.
Because it was something I was experiencing, and the presence that used to come into the room, I could only say that I could never quite track it psychically. I could never actually establish what it was, although I thought it to be male and quite a sort of, you know, large physical presence of a male.
Like a bear.
It used to vanish quickly. Like
a gay spectral bear. It was
a big, big gay spectral bear, but just violent in its nature. So it was, yeah. But that... was it. That was my experience with it. And in the end, it got so bad, I actually took the videotape and I smashed it to bits in the middle of the room and just like shattered my head off, because I got so angry about it, because it kept happening and kept happening. I was just like there, like saying to it, this is fucking you! Smash!
And it stopped after that, did it?
Yeah, and it did. Ooh. So I just had to make, you know, real strong and assertive threats basically on the psychic realm to try and get the energy out there, that I wouldn't be, you know, this is my space, my house, and I wouldn't be violated in that way. But it did stop. So it's very rare that it's ever happened again. I mean, really, really rare. But at one time it was, I nearly had the house exercised because it was getting so bad. In the end, that's why I used to sleep downstairs in my front room by the fire, because I would not sleep in the bedroom. But why would that film in particular be appeared outside the house behind the car?
And there's a particularly creepy film. I watched that on my own, and I watched it in the daytime as well, and it still gave me the chills watching it.
Yeah, I did. It's disturbing.
It's the sound of when the actual the entity or whatever it is strikes, there's like a really harsh, repetitive sound that it's like a almost like a synth stabbing sound, but it's very harsh.
Ding, ding, ding,
yeah.
Ding, isn't it?
If I can find a soundbite of it, I'll play it at the end of this section. But it's really disturbing. And when you listen to that, it sends like a rush of adrenaline through your body. It gives you
the chills right now, just thinking about it. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if was it Doris Bither, the woman who was the actual victim? I mean, if that was a genuine thing, like the ghostly rape that just carried on, I mean, that's a horrific thing to go through. I mean, I know that the film actually ventures off into the realms of fantasy at the end, where they catch it, don't they? They freeze it in liquid nitrogen in like a block of ice.
There's
like a blue sort of lightning or something that they catch in liquid nitrogen, which obviously that kind of, you know, if you believe that bit happened, then, you know, well, it's obviously
the phenomenon did actually happen, didn't it? It happened under test circumstances in a laboratory. That side of it, the actual in the laboratory side of it, she was recorded in the laboratory under attack on film. So from that point of view, you know, the actual attacks were real. It wasn't just her going, "Oh, I've been, you know, molested by a ghost," but the actual attacks did happen when she was asleep on. It was recorded in a laboratory, wasn't it, of people witnessing it?
Yeah.
So these cases, I don't know how, you know, prevalent they are. You don't really hear about them, but then is it something which people would necessarily come along and disclose?
Well, you do hear about them if you look at them in the context of old hag syndrome. When you wake up, it's almost like a waking dream. It's almost like your brain wakes up before your body wakes up and you're paralysed. So in that respect, you do feel like you've been pinned to the bed. And I've had an experience of that before, and I'm pretty sure I've spoken about it in the past on one of the other shows. But I had a series of events that happened to me when I started going out with my wife, and I moved into her apartment, and it all happened in the daytime. So she'd get up and go to work, and I'd have an extra sort of hour in bed because I lived closer and didn't have to be in work so early. And I remember it was probably about July, and the sun was streaming through the blinds, and I was half awake, half asleep. You know, when you just kind of dozing, you think, "Oh, I'll give it another 15 minutes before I get up." And then as I was lying there, I heard the strangest sound, and it was like a droning sound, but high-pitched. But it was actually coming from inside my head, like tinnitus, as opposed to being an external sound source. So I thought that was really odd. And I lay there, and as that happened, the bed behind me sank down as if someone had just sat on the end of the bed behind me. And I felt the whole bed just go doof and sink. And I just lay there, and I thought, who the fuck is that? Because I'm obviously in the flat, in the apartment on my own. So I try to roll over to see who it is, but my body is completely paralyzed. I cannot move or roll over to see what is sitting behind me at all. So what I managed to force my way with all of my might to try and get onto my back, and it was physically, it was probably like being pinned down by about three blokes, as if I was like in a bear hug by three blokes and trying to force against it. If you can imagine the amount of energy that would take. And I managed to get onto my back, and I looked, and actually in the corner of the bed where the bed had sunk down, there was like a dip in the bed, almost like two arse cheek marks on the duvet on that corner of the bed. And as soon as I managed to roll over onto my back, there was a huge release, and whatever it was kind of let go, and I got like a massive adrenaline rush, and I just didn't know what to do with myself. It was the weirdest, one of the weirdest experiences I've ever had. But I didn't tell anyone about it, and I never told Monique about it because I didn't want to freak her out. So I was a bit in the mornings. I was a bit sort of, I don't really want to have a lie in anymore. So about a week later, it kind of all died down, and it kind of drifted into the background. And I was lying in bed again. This time I was lying on my front, and it was about the same time again, daylight outside. And I was lying on my front with my, using my sort of my right arm as a pillow. So, you know, like when you sort of cradle your head type thing on top of the pillow.
Yeah.
And again, I was lying there on my front, and to the left of me, the bed started to sink down again on the left-hand side of the bed. And I immediately lifted my head up right? But this time, I tried to open my eyes, but my eyelids were glued together. Like, no matter how hard I tried to open my eyes, I couldn't physically open my eyes. It was almost like, it was, you know, when you get conjunctivitis and they're glued together. It was exactly like that. So what I did, I held myself up with one arm, and with my left hand, I actually forced my eyelids apart so I could see what was happening. And this is no word of a lie. The duvet on my wife's side of the bed was folding back on its own as if something was getting into bed.
And it was
lifting up and folding back on itself. So it was lifting up probably about over a foot in the air and folding back. And what I was doing is I was then letting go of my eye and then pushing the duvet back down with my other hand. And like I was just pushing it back. And then I would open my eye again with my fingers and the duvet would continue to fold back on its own. And it did it about three times until I just literally fucking jumped onto that side of the bed and ripped the duvet back on my own and like literally threw the duvet across the room and I was sitting on that side of the bed. Then all of a sudden, my eyelids were free and I could, they were open again. And there was no sign or anything. It was the strangest thing ever. But I distinctly felt that whatever it was trying to get into bed with me. Not, I don't know if it was trying to do anything sexual with me, but it was almost like a spirit partner just coming to bed, as if someone had just come off the night shift and they were getting into bed. And it was the strangest thing ever. And we used to hear shuffling around in the hall and lights would turn on their own and all that. And I just went into the living room one day and I just said, look, whoever you are, we don't mind you being here, but respect our space and our privacy. We'll respect yours. And we found that if you shut the doors, that was a sign of privacy. So if you shut the bedroom door, nothing ever happened in the bedroom. If you left the bedroom door open, things would happen. And the same thing with any other room in the house. So the doors actually became barriers. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yes, maybe that's what... Maybe Larry Grayson was trying to give that advice years ago to people.
Yeah, shut that door.
I actually do. I shut the door on the bedroom and I lock it. That was my defence. That literally, if I left the door open, then I would be prone to, you know, predations, but basically psychically protecting the room and, you know, actually making that intention to shut the doors, physically, symbolically shutting, locking the door, bolting the door, bolted the space. And that's what I began to sort of enforce was, and I still do it to this day. And that seems to be, you know, it does actually work. And then obviously, you know, throughout the night, what I'd hear is I'd hear stuff happening in the house and things. I used to have a wind chime on the end of my sort of curtain rail on the landing. And, you know, periodically that would just get thrown down the stairs and stuff like that. So, you know, it's not something that can be dislodged by itself. But these are the sort of phenomena that you experience. I think it's just a case of people need to understand that you cannot take this stuff lightly. And you do need to be really, really careful. Because, you know, if you do get the wrong thing, like something that can actually physically move stuff. And like you say, Dan, pin you down and move the duvet. You know, that is terrifying. That's real manifestation. That's real physical manifestation. So,
it's one of those weird things. I didn't know if I'd kind of half slipped into a almost like a dimensional state where I was equally as part of it as whatever the spirit was. It didn't, if you know what I mean. It was like, it was almost, it wasn't quite as if the spirit was there trying to get in bed with me purposefully and I was unable to stop it. But it was almost like if there's two dimensions, we kind of met halfway and neither of us probably knew what the other thing was. If that makes any sense. Because I wasn't able to really interact with it, but there was something there that was preventing me from opening my eyes or moving my body, or so there was limitations in place which I can't explain. But of course, there's also the famous ghost shagging sequence from the film Ghost, with Patrick Swayze.
Of course,
on the
yeah.
On the, is that when, that's not when they're on the spinning, the clay, the thing,
wheel.
Is it? The Potter's Wheel.
Yeah.
Making
he
huge
on,
knobs
though,
out of clay.
Yeah, it's Tuesday. Yeah, it's quite a popular. It's more popular than we realise. Then this, what's it called? Spectrophilia.
I think it is. Yeah, I mean, you can also attribute things like wet dreams and stuff to the possibility of a certain percentage of them being spiritual interaction. I mean, we don't know what dreams are anyway. If they are a kind of, as we've discussed before, a almost like living another life in another dimension, and you're doing something in that dimension that then has a almost carries over to your physical body when you exit, type thing. I don't know. I mean, we've all been teenage boys once, so.
Because, exactly,
I think surely for a male to orgasm, surely there has to be some kind of mechanics involved with it. I've never actually experienced it. You know, where you can just go 3, 2, 1. Hey,
Sting can he? Sting can do it.
Yeah, Sting can. Yeah.
Oh, they are. They've mastered it.
Yeah, just concentrate.
But, without any. It takes a lot of concentration on my part, I think.
Yeah.
That's why he's saying that stands so close to me, because it sets him off every time.
Yeah, at least someone's setting your budgies off as well, by the sounds of it.
Yeah, I think when I'm talking, they think I'm talking to them, so they join in, they have conversations, and they're in a very happy mood today.
Chatting away, Is it sunny down there, Freddie? Like, sort of getting the sun.
It is. Yeah. Do you know what was weird the other day? Was it yesterday? I think it was, right? Today's sunny, but the other day it was sunny, right? But when the sun was blistering hot, it snowed, right? Then we had rain while it was sunny, and then lightning while it was sunny, all the same time. All these hailstones complete. This morning it was freezing cold and raining, now it's sunny. It's bad.
That's right. We've had snow this morning. Snow this morning, hailstones yesterday. It's like sunny sky, then suddenly hailstones, and then sunny this morning, snowing, hailing, and then it's back to sun again. So just unbelievably strange weather.
Look at that seaside this time of year. It's all gamble, it's all lottery. If you take a Saturday and go to the seaside, it's either have a lovely day in the sunshine, or you could have sitting in the pissing rain with a deck chair all soggy.
Yeah, and all miserable.
Yeah, exactly. Typical British seaside holiday, you know.
So are we? We're all on the same wavelength when we believe that naughty
erotic encounters with the spirit world.
Yeah erotic entities exist. Sexy spirits.
Yeah,
and I think they're to be discouraged unless you are really, really psychically aware or very clairvoyant, or even then, why would you do it? It's a bit concerning that people want to do it just because how dangerous entity attachment can become. You know, the worst case of entity attachment I've ever seen happened to a young guy that I knew after we were doing some work and dabbling, and he basically went absolutely mental and tried to cut his face up with a broken glass.
And then like in Poltergeist.
Then I had no recollection of what had happened. So that's a clear case where something really got a grip of him, took over him completely, and then he, went really nasty, and he tried to harm him, tried to cut his face off with a glass. It was just like, okay. So, it is real.
Don't discourage it. However, if you're the two girls in the article on BuzzFeed, then it looks like that might be your only hope of... Are those biscuits, Freddie?
No. A chocolate bar getting here, really.
Sounded like Stephen Hawking eating crisps, then.
Stephen, did he eat crisps?
No, but you went all... Yeah, your Skype feed is very odd again. Your Skype feed is very bizarre again.
Walked a bit.
The thing is, though, if you was like, say, I've asked Stephen Hawking, is they gave him that voice box, like a speaking spell, it's like American, isn't it? But imagine the money you could make if you brought out ones with different accents on. You can make a lot of money with that. You'd go on Dragon's Den with that, couldn't you? Do you know what I mean? You could have a different accent. So if you were Geordie, you'd want to say, we man, okay, do this, yeah. You want to speak like that. You don't want to speak, hey, American accent, do you? You want to have your own accent. A Scottish one. Yeah, that's the right thing.
a Scottish
company. That'd only be fair, wouldn't it? I'm surprised.
Well, I have two ideas with that.
Must have done it.
But it's got to be done. I mean,
it's itself. Patent it.
Yeah. The other quickly. Idea I had similar to that was like I had the idea of these voice boxes like Stephen Hawking for different accents, you know what I mean? So people can like an Irish accent, you know. And also I thought of a sat nav, right? Which changes accent whichever place you go into. So well, you drive good. Through East London, go down the left, mate, turn a left, or you know, that's the wrong point. And you go to Birmingham, just go down there to Spaghetti Junction and turn off. So that's all the accents, so where you go. So you go down to Bristol, like, you go down there, okay, take the front right, so it slows down. So when you're in Bristol, it's very calm like that. Just take them down there. Go left, right. That's it. Lovely. And all that. Then you go, wherever you go in the country, the accent will change.
That's a good idea, yeah, actually. Manchester, I can't quite like that.
Yeah, Manchester. Hey, our kid, take the next left. Hey, take the next left. Our kid.
Hey, top banana. You're out, your majesty.
Yeah, you're out of your destination. Sorted. The scouts went, hey, Dave, don't we? Hey, look at that. Hey, go left, right. Go right there.
Don't pull up.
Yeah, that'd be good, wouldn't it?
So, it's very confusing for foreigners, though. I think English people, you know, people in the UK would get away with using it, but as soon as foreigners came over, they'd get confused to hell.
It'd help them integrate, wouldn't it? Do you know what I mean? If they're trying to learn English and they're using an accent which is understand, you know, if they go to Scotland, they could pick up the accent by the direction they've been receiving. Yeah, so they sound more Scottish, for instance.
That's great. It's really, they can understand colloquialisms. Colloquialisms a lot better, couldn't they? And they would actually feel far more integrated. And what an enjoyable experience, though, having all these diverse accents as you was driving down the country. That'd be a rich. I mean, that would be a holiday in itself, wouldn't it? Could you imagine it?
Would be. Yeah, I think, like, you know, the radio station changes when you go from one place to another. You get different radio stations. The accent could also change on the sat. And I think that would definitely work. Do you know what I mean? And also European, you know. But if it speaks English, you could go like, say you're driving in Germany, you go exit now, and all that kind of stuff. So you get, you know, French went, turn left, third exit. Oh. So wherever a country you go to, it changes. So worldwide, the odds you are like, hey, mate, you know. Because you get a few accents on there on the sat nav. You get the Irish one called Sean, which is on the TomTom. We sometimes use that. The Irish accent's much better than the English one. And there's an Australian one, and there's also a South African one. So we've used those before. But there's ones like Urdu and this kind of thing, but they weren't in English. They were actually in Urdu rather than an Indian accent. I thought that would be really good to put that on, but couldn't understand it when it was directed to me. But
there you go. There's your next Kickstarter project lined up, anyway.
I've got to say,
that's the way to do it.
It's got legs, that has, definitely. Yep.
Yeah, definitely, Dragon's Den. I reckon Old Iron Sugar would be impressed by that, wouldn't he? You know, and only Old Dragon's Den, I reckon that could definitely be a winner.
Yeah, yeah. I'm out, but
I'm in.
Duncan Ballantyne. Yeah,
it'd be me and Freddie just doing the accents all day long, wouldn't it?
Yeah,
making ourselves,
right, wouldn't it?
reading every street in the UK onto what a nightmare job. No, that's not for me.
Get in front of them, they'd be like, "This, did you two record these voices yourselves?" We'd be like, "No, mate." They'd be like, "Who did, didn't you?" We're like, "Well, we couldn't help it, mate. It was such a laugh."
It would be. I bet it's like it worked. Do you know what I mean? If someone's coming to England, they want an experience of England. Not everybody talks the Queen's English and. Hello, you know, they're not all posh, you know, so they could hear
difficult accents like the Derby, Nottingham accent, Derby, you know.
I've got a Derby accent. Hard. It's not that bad, is it? Yeah, I'm from Derby. Derby. Hey, old me duck.
Whereas if you drive down a council estate, you could have a different accent.
You could.
Like you go in a posh area, like, okay, take the next left, old boy. And Castle say, God damn, go down the fucking right, guy. No, go on, guy. Quick, move.
Yeah, quick, mate. Go, no, get on it. Nah, in it. That way. No, left. No, you arsehole.
The cop shop. Go past the cop shop. Quick, speed, accelerate, guy. Go down there.
Large it.
Different.
Don't ask me how it works. It just do.
It just do, guy. Well, it's definitely money in that. Definitely money in
that. Definitely. How do we get from erotic entities onto sat-nav accents?
Stephen Hawking, it was strange.
Because you did your Stephen Hawking eating chocolate or whatever it was.
Yeah. Can he eat chocolate? I mean, I don't know how he's fed, really.
I think he's probably by syringe, I would have thought. Through his ear.
Through his ear.
I don't know, poor bloke. I've no idea how, but it must be terrible. Like Robocop, all he eats is baby food.
Yeah, exactly. So he actually
dabbles
in Doctor Who, and he's the same sort of thing, I suppose, isn't it? You know?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It's a terrible state to be in, but obviously he still does a lot for the for science.
He makes money out of it.
Oh, of course, yeah. You know, he's a household name, isn't he?
Exactly, yeah.
Yes. So,
you've got a unique selling point.
That's it. So, that was the Fortean Oracle. As I say, it always goes off on a bit of a tangent at some point. But if you back us via Patreon at the Inner Sanctum level, you also get access to the Arcane Chapters. And so where we're going to head right now, and we're going to record an extra 45 to 50 minutes on other paranormal subjects that take our fancy. So if you fancy listening to an additional 45, 50 minutes of us three wittering on about our experiences with the supernatural, then all you have to do is head over onto Patreon and back us at the Inner Sanctum level, and you'll also get access to the Vault of Secrets, which is an exclusive backer area, which is full of exclusive material and content that is worth, I'd probably say, in excess of £100. Or $140 if you're American.
Definitely.
So,
yeah. But I'd say it's priceless, I would say.
It is priceless, yeah. So, we'll take a short break, and we'll be back in a moment.
You can claim this is just a random shadow, interference, digital fakery. But look into the dark depths of history, and it's clear that this isn't some technological glitch. Fleeting glimpses and frightened whispers tell of a dark figure that, for hundreds of years, has haunted the land. A silent shade, always present wherever there is pain, suffering, and death.
Hello and welcome back to the Mystic Menagerie podcast. We've now got a regular back to the show, and it's Thom Burgess, who is the editor of the Spectral Times, and is here to talk about a very new, interesting project that he's been working on that's been under wraps for quite a while, and we've been dying to talk about it, but we've been under strict instruction not to talk about it, but now we've got the green light, and we thought we'd get Thom on the show, and he can spill the beans himself. So welcome back to the Mystic Menagerie podcast, Thom.
Thanks very much. Hi, Dan. Hi, Freddie. It's good to be back.
Yeah, good to have you back on the show again, Thom. And you've been a very busy man, haven't you, with everything you've been up to?
It's been quite busy last year. Myself and a friend of mine called Toby Meekins, who's a director, we've been working on putting together a concept short for something which ties in with my comic Malevolence, which is like a sci-fi supernatural short film called Ghoster.
Wow.
And the trailer is actually up on it's up on Vimeo at the moment, I believe. Is that right?
Yeah. You can watch it on Vimeo, on Toby's Vimeo, and also on YouTube as well. And then there's also some further press links on theghostproject.com. And there's a few other bits and pieces of art flying around as well, which is done by a really talented guy called Joe Becci, who's the illustrator from Malevolence 1. He's been kind enough to help with it as well.
Brilliant. I mean, I remember when you came over to the studio quite a while ago now. It's almost, not quite a year, but I'd say 9 months ago, you came over to the studio and you told me all about the Ghost project, and you brought the concept design book with you as well. And you told me the outline of the story and what it involves. And it was just like a huge creative rush. I could see so many avenues that this project could go down in terms of film, comics, computer games. It kind of occupies every single area of modern media that it could possibly go down any of those routes and be successful. And so do you want to give people just a quick sort of synopsis of what the Ghost of story is about, and then they'll probably understand why I'm so excited about it.
That's very kind of you. It's been something I've been working on for years on and off. And it's this whole kind of concept, which initially I wanted to do a large scale graphic novel, but obviously not really having any experience in comics and that kind of field, started off with Malevolence. So basically it's effectively like the world is plagued by vicious malevolence. And malevolence, if you don't know, are really like the worst kind of ghosts out there. So they're the most violent, most dangerous. And
like, Jimmy, like a Jimmy Savile ghost.
Just that's a whole film.
itself, yeah.
Completely. And the premise that goes through is effectively that these ghosts have just been running wild across the UK, causing terror, killing people. And amidst it all, there's the story picks up on a 21-year-old dropout who's just dropped out of college. Finds himself in a place in the world where he's still trying to work out what he wants, and he finds he's got a birthright to become a spectral assassin, which is a ghoster, and effectively uncovers that the fact that the UK itself is looked after by specific territories by specific families, and they all carry these this kind of this privilege to go out and hunt ghosts. So from that story, I've been working on it, as I say, for years, and I met Toby last year probably. So we spoke, and I really loved his work. He's got some fantastic short films following kind of the premise of supernatural occurrences. I've both got a huge mutual love of M.R. James. And he's been signed to 360 Management in LA. So
wow.
So we were both given like an opportunity where he said that he was quite keen to potentially take the story forward with me if I was interested. So we've been working on it solidly for the last year. The outcome was a short that we shot last September in London in an old Victorian dock.
Yeah.
Amidst a tattoo festival upstairs, which was quite crazy, because this strange kind of supernatural short going on downstairs with a girl being slowly hunted by something that, without giving the game away, without you're not quite sure of. And then occasionally, like, tattooed men appearing just with pints of beer, just obviously going like down the wrong
alleyway. What's going off down here, sort of thing. Yeah.
Some cool VIP room, which, yeah, looked really confusing. It's literally, I think it went live on Vimeo probably about 3 weeks ago now.
Yeah.
And it's just been a case of just getting the word out there, in people's reactions. And so far, to say, it's been, yeah, generally positive. So, great. So yeah, it's just kind of seeing how it goes, really.
Yeah, I think we've had the trailer up on the Mystic Menagerie Facebook feed, haven't we, Freddie? I think at some point.
Yes, we have. I put the actual
We'll put it on the we'll put it on the page as well. The actual on the website.
Yeah, it got a very good response from people, you know, and you know, it is the sort of thing that I think people that listen to the show would want us definitely want to see.
Yeah. One thing that really I liked about the whole concept of the story is obviously the way the particular houses of or the families are all split up, and that's like the. Am I giving anything away by telling how they're split up?
No, by all means.
No, they're split up by like the ley lines in the UK, and yeah, is this correct? The ley lines actually form the boundaries of these different ghost hunting families. Is that right? Yeah.
That's it completely. And it's something which, I mean, for us in Kent, I've grown up always knowing about ley lines. We've got places like Leybourne and Bluebell Hill, which is notorious for supernatural happenings. And you've got like strange stone circles, which I know you've talked about on the show before, but other kind of odd things, which always seem to be around ley lines. And I've just always been fascinated by it and the connection to ancient historical druidic landmarks and also supernatural occurrences. So it just seemed a natural progression for the story.
Yeah, it's got for me.
Yeah.
It's got all the hallmarks. It's. I mean, the way it's split up into families and the progression of the story, it does strike me a little bit like Harry Potter, but good. if you know what I mean, I know, but I mean that kind of the hero cycle, which I think. It sounds like it follows is a familiar cycle. Almost every single popular story or successful story follows that pattern of you know, someone who is what appears to be normal discovering something and then going on an epic journey and then encountering something bad and then that makes them a better person and so on and so forth. So that it definitely revolves around the hero cycle, doesn't it? And but in a more, I would say, in a more adult fashion. It's I wouldn't say it's aimed at, what's the sort of target audience for Ghost? Are you looking at the kind of sort of late teens, sort of mid-20s, or is it aimed at the whole, encompassing all age groups?
I mean, ideally, I suppose it would be encompassing all age groups, but yeah, specifically that late teens into, yeah, sort of early 30s, I guess.
Yeah, or the geek culture, basically, which can which basically spreads, well, at least well into the 40s, as I'm well aware, but...
Exactly. It's good, because now it seems to be an excuse these days to kind of be a geek in, as, you know, to what kind of ever age you want to be. So,
yeah,
you know, I'm sure when someone pegs like 80 and there's obviously like a generation of geek that are like now pensioners, that'll be absolutely fine still. So, yeah, no, completely. It very much takes a lot of elements of the hero cycle and, you know, obviously sort of going right back to Greek myths and like a slightly lost protagonist.
Yeah.
Finding himself, and then, you know, a moment of self-doubt and then overcoming it. But there's a treatment that we've got down, and it's a huge story, and hopefully it'd be you know, be a fantastic thing to get an opportunity to kind of to take it further. So it's good to see it. At least it's having an initial positive reaction, which is it's great to see.
Yeah, I mean the artwork encompasses so many sort of things I love. It's very gothic. There's a few steampunk elements in there, but one thing I really liked about it is it doesn't go too steampunk, you know what I mean? So many things have jumped on the steampunk bandwagon these days. I know it's one of Freddie's kind of pet hates. It seems to be stitched onto a hell of a lot of things nowadays for no apparent reason, but yours seems to stem more from a more sort of gothic horror background, and from what I can gather from the artwork anyway.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah,
it's definitely got its own. It's definitely got its own signature look to it. You know, you could, if someone's to say, if there was this was a ghost, a computer game, for example, you could tell, you'd be able to tell by the artwork and the world, it was Ghoster, because the artwork for it is exceptional.
Oh, thanks. We've been, I'd say, really lucky with our artist who did Malevolence 1 for me, Joe Becci. He did a fantastic job on the press shots, it's very much a huge fan of steampunk, but I completely agree. I think there's so many different games now as well, like Dishonored and The Order, and they all clearly take a lot of influence from previous outings of steampunk.
Yeah,
and that, you know, you kind of think there's a motive there for a lot of them, or an agenda anyway, to try and get that adapted into a movie. Whilst I really wanted something which stood alone, and it's very much like a nod at, like, absolute kind of like excuse me, Victoriana coming into the 21st century, and a huge influence as well, just being in the southeast for the Talia shots, who's the main character.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of locations which are taking inspiration from them, from around Kent as well.
Yeah, excellent. I mean, I was kicking myself. I think I said it to you before. I was like, when you told me the whole concept of the story and all the different avenues it can possibly go down, I was like, fuck, why didn't I think of this first? It's just one of those things that it's so good. And one thing I need to ask you, though, and it is a bit of a favour, and I know Freddie will back me up on this, if it goes to Hollywood, can me and Freddie get like a little bit part in it? Even, you know, like a cameo role, like Daniel Craig in Star Wars?
Yeah.
Right? Can we be, I don't know, maybe a pair of ghosts or something?
We'd be good ghosts, wouldn't we?
Well, no, I'd want to be an evil. I like the evil ones, to be honest.
No, but we'd be good at playing.
Oh, we'd be good ghosts.
Yeah,
we would. We'd be good bad ghosts.
Yeah, oh, definitely.
I love that. Yeah, no, absolutely. As long as you turn up, if they, you know, this is obviously pie in the sky stuff, but if there was a premiere and you turned up dressed as ghosts as well, that would be.
Yeah, we're up for that. Yeah,
I'd be on the red carpet. Yeah, excellent. I'll be on the red carpet signing girls' cleavages with a big fat marker pen.
Girls screaming in terror. I think that's a fantastic idea. Maybe just amidst this kind of big Buster just having a couple of Rentigo style British ghosts would be would be the perfect
Timothy
fit.
Claypole.
Exactly. Well, that, yeah, no, absolutely. Needless to say, if that ever happens, which it'd be pie in the sky stuff, but absolutely be fantastic to have you as ghosts.
We'll return the favour if we ever get a TV something commissioned for TV as well. We'll return the favour and have you on there. I don't know what doing, but we'll find something.
and hopefully the Japanese TV takes off then. Perhaps it could be a ghost of special.
There could be, yeah, definitely. I mean, you could see that type of thing fitting well well into Japanese culture. It's the sort of thing you definitely wander around Forbidden Planet, and I can imagine, I can see ghost action figures hanging on the shelves and... and maybe a bit of ghost or cosplay going on.
That'd be an absolute dream. The mask we had done for the short was really great, seeing that come to life. But just what one of the families, it would be absolutely amazing to see some other ones. For us, we had the main problem was without giving too much away, because there's an element of movement with the mask, which we had to kind of try and work out a logistical way of doing it without killing the person who was wearing it. So,
right.
So that was really interesting. But yeah, no, absolutely. I would absolutely love to see it taken into. I'm a huge Funko Pop collector and just general plastic merchandise tat. Absolutely. I'd love to see it taken into that sort of arena.
What's the next stage now then? What's on the cards next? So the trailer's out. I take it you're now working on the actual... are you actually working on the short film itself, or are you waiting for other people to jump on board and fund it more? Or?
Well, at the moment, we're kind of... The initial thought was to get out there to see what people's reactions were. We've got a treatment for potentially a feature... Or something, to be honest, with the scale of it, it could be something much larger. So even something episodic, or even within a publisher kind of environment. So maybe taking it to a publication would be fantastic. So we've got a few meetings on the go, and we're just taking it slow and chatting over some ideas. But as I say, it's an absolutely huge story. It ties in with Malevolence 2 and 3. 2's due out next month, and then 3 to follow, which all roll in the actual storyline of Ghoster itself. So, but post the madness of getting those out, we quite happily see where it goes meeting-wise.
Brilliant.
Brilliant. That sounds great, Thom. When are you expecting? You've got a rough date for this? Is it all coming together at the moment, would you say?
I couldn't put a date or anything for Ghost there. It's very much just kind of in the hands of, as I say, sort of, it's very hard, but it's like, it's just literally we're talking with quite a few people and just seeing how it goes. But in terms of Malevolence is like early next month, which has been heavily delayed. I've actually got the pages on my desktop now. They're just having the final words going on. And then Malevolence 3 follows probably officially for later on this year. With Ghoster, I mean, we'd love to get something done as soon as possible. It'd be, as I say, within that publication or as a feature or within a TV environment. It's just kind of, we're just going to wait and see really and see what happens.
Yeah, would you ever go down the Kickstarter route, you think, or are you kind of a bit cautious of that thing?
I think it's good. Don't get me wrong. I think it's a tricky one. In terms of the scale of this, we'd like to do something which really does it properly, which you just can logistically kickstart it.
No.
But don't get me wrong. I think Kickstarter's fantastic, and I think to people with like an established reputation, it's a fantastic asset. Especially if you're following up an existing publication with another. Though having said that, I know I don't know how you both feel about it. I saw yesterday there's like a short doing the rounds for, I always get his name wrong. I think Stephen ML, who plays the Arrow.
All right, yeah.
So him and his brother have put out a short for like a film they want to make, which has earned, I think, I might be wrong here, but it's like hundreds of thousands of dollars already.
Mm. And that's purely because he's a well-known actor, though, as well, isn't it? So it's the groundwork's already there because of his name and his following, I suppose.
Completely. And I think that's kind of unfair to, you know, if you're just, you know, Joe Blogs and you're starting off and you're trying to maybe push a book or a comic or, you know, a new product. I do think that it's kind of balanced in your favour doing it if you're a Hollywood movie star.
Yeah, it has its pitfalls as well. I've done, you know, a few Kickstarters in the past, and I'm lucky because I've got quite a nice bunch of people who follow me. But when you start getting into the realms of other marketing areas, I suppose, like film and music, you open yourself up to a lot more shit from people who don't understand the fact that they're backing you. They're not actually buying something. So you'll get people who've backed you, but they kind of want their products almost immediately. And you're like, well, hold on, this is a creative process that could take years. And if you're wanting stuff immediately, you should never have backed me in the first place. And instead of putting all of that energy into creating something, you're actually putting a hell of a lot of energy into just dampening fire, you know, putting fires out all the time. And I think the cons far outweigh the pros with Kickstarter, I've come to realise, even though I am going to be doing another one at some point. It's a dodgy place to be, and I think you're doing it the right way around.
Oh, thanks. Don't get me wrong, I absolutely loved your the one you had up for the fairy kit, which I thought was beautifully put together. And you know, I thought, you know, it's kind of, if you had needed a template for how to do a Kickstarter, well, that this is it, because it's straight away intriguing and enticing, and there's no reason why you wouldn't back it. But yeah, I completely agree. At the same time, I think there's people just have no expectation for like a platform that's selling creative services, actually understanding the creative process behind it, and that you're not going to get something sent to you the following day. It can be quite hard for some people to understand.
Yeah, I backed an album 4 years ago, and it was by the chap who wrote the music for Skyrim. And I thought, oh, this will make a great Christmas present for my son, who was at the time 11. He's now 15, and we still haven't got it. he's still writing the music. And I'm like, shit.
But this was
in the early days of Kickstarter, where I didn't understand the backer process.
Yeah.
He does regular updates and that, but a lot of people have just dropped, you know, them and had refunds and stuff, because it's just taking far too long. Some people are actually, well, is he ever going to write it, or is it just kind of he's spent all the money on hookers and fast cars and now is, you know, just relaxing by a pool somewhere with our money? Who knows? But I've got some faith in hoping that I'm going to get this soundtrack one day, by which
there's
time
a bloke who did that. He put on customized Ouija boards on a Kickstarter. Took all the money, and then he disappeared, just vanished off Facebook, changed his phone number. Because what it was, I think he couldn't afford to make them, or he didn't estimate it properly. So when he got to making these Ouija boards, he couldn't provide them.
Now, can he actually tell you his name and what he is? Because I backed that, and I lost. Yeah. I lost my £30. So here we go.
He's the bloke who's doing my old website. You know, he's doing my website, host it for me. And of course, what happened is when he disappeared, my website went as well.
Simon Vanderbilt, his name
that's
is.
Him, yeah.
Simon Vanderbilt, Vanderbilt yeah. Is an RAF reserve and is a fucking scumbag. So if he's listening to this, I do know where you live. And if I'm ever up that neck of the woods, I'm going to... Or you can give me my £30 back. It's up to you.
Yeah, there was motivation to pay someone back. There you go.
Yeah, I can't be bothered to actually go up there and get my £30. But if I'm just passing, you know, if I just sort of think, oh, actually, I'm in the vicinity and I've got a...
So
exactly.
I've heard some like real horror stories as well. Like there was one doing the rounds last year. I don't know if you both saw it. I think some guy got something small, like a comic he got published, and then he didn't deliver on time, and then rather than like refunding people back, he recorded a video of himself just burning the product, and he was like, every time you complain, I'm just going to burn some more of these that you're not getting, which is really weird, sort of holding people to ransom almost, I suppose. Yeah. That, you know, either.
Well, there is no law with it. You know, there is no laws with Kickstarter. There's no legislation in place. It's you know, you hand your money over and that's it. If you don't get anything back for your money, there's no legal route you can go down to recoup any of it.
That's right.
A lot of people do exploit it.
Completely. I recently had some issues with a Kickstarter project and chatting to them. They seem to have there's no kind of guidelines. So you could, I don't know, for instance, you could put on a concert, maybe say, I don't know, someone like one of your favourite bands, perhaps, like Coldplay or something like that, playing, sell loads of tickets and then not necessarily have Coldplay at the end from their kind of terms and conditions.
Yeah.
It seems to be ambiguous. They won't necessarily actually what's the word, kind of take someone off, you know, remove someone's campaign if that's the case.
No, so. No. But we're not like that. And, you know, it's if you ever did get down that route, I'm sure it would be highly successful. But as you know, you need to have gain some ground and have a bit of a following before you ever do anything like that. But as I say, yeah. you're doing it. You're going to do it. I think you're doing it the right way by staying out of that environment.
Definitely, yeah. 100%.
Yeah. So, what about the Spectral Times? Is there? I'll take it because you've been working so much on Ghoster. The Spectral Times has taken a bit of a back seat at the moment. Is that right?
Yeah, it has. We're at the moment putting one together, which hopefully should be out over the next month, which is going to be like a Ghoster special following up on and everything that's been going on, and also just an update on a few interesting new hauntings and supernatural occurrences in the area. But at the moment, linked in with that, Great British Ghost is having a revival, and I'm working with a really talented writer called Kev Elson, who's putting together, slowly compiling, which is a huge fast task, like a directory of hauntings across the UK. So at the moment, it's kind of just Kev just going through. He started this ages ago, but going through haunted pub, churches. It's phenomenally vast. But yeah, needless to say, when that relaunches, that will be a much more of a comprehensive guide to hauntings across the UK.
Great. You're very busy at the moment, then. You've got a finger in a hell of a lot of pies.
yeah, it's good. It keeps me out of trouble, and days go quick. So
it's like spinning plates, though, isn't it? You have to sort of. It's hard to keep them all spinning at the same speed. You have to kind of keep going back and having a go at each thing, you know, a little bit at each time, and then before you know it, you've actually got somewhere with it. But once you're in the middle of it, you don't actually feel like you're making any progress. That's what I feel like, anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's you just keep thinking of the end game, thinking, oh, it's it'll all be worth it. Come the end of the year when there's two final comics to go with Malevolence One and hopefully some move Ghoster. Yeah, it is a lot of work, but no, it's fantastic, and I'm very much looking forward to working with you guys with the Doomsday event as well.
Yeah, we still need to, as soon as I've got the Whitby one out of the way, I'm going to be concentrating on plugging that one as much as possible and trying to shift some tickets, so it'll be interesting to see what we can do with that. So, well, great. Well, thanks a lot for joining us on the show again, Thom. I know you're a busy guy, and but we'll get you back on again soon. Let us know as soon as you get any more news regarding Ghoster and Malevolence or the Spectral Times, and we'll be glad to have you back on board again, and you can tell us all about it.
Most definitely. Well, thanks for having me on, and have a great day.
Hello and welcome back to the final part of the Mystic Menagerie podcast, episode 20. We've reached number 20, isn't it? Fantastic, Dan. It's a landmark, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it is. And it's been a fun-packed show again. We've really managed to cram it in. I mean, even more so in episode 21, we're going to have even more sections. We're trying to keep the sections more tight and concise and less rambling. It's pretty hard
and
to
new
do,
things
though.
As well. Yeah, we're trying to have something new each month, something to look forward to, so it's each different, it's a bit of variety, you know. Each time, you know, something unusual, we like to pull things out of the bag. So the show's about weirdness, really. Do you know what I mean? Whether it's paranormal weirdness, whether it's just weirdness in art, whatever it is, strange and unusual things each month. So hopefully we bring some surprises to people and stuff you've not heard about or not seen before. So try and keep all that fresh for you.
Yeah, it's quite different. I mean, I was obviously being the producer and listening to a lot of podcasts as well. I do listen to a lot of other podcasts that are really highly polished, and you know, the presenters are what you would typically call radio presenters. But,
yeah.
you know, we've got our signature style, and it's one of those things that, you know, if you like that particular style, then you'll carry on listening to us. If you like other styles, and then you'll listen to other types of podcasts. So,
definitely,
you know, it's like, you know, different news channels all have different ways of presenting the news. So, you know, and we are aware of the way we present stuff, and we're trying to tighten it up a little bit, and we get in there, and it's taken us 20 episodes. But you know, we can't change the people we are, and that's the way we talk, basically.
Keeping it fun and natural. Yeah, I mean, I listen to some podcasts, and like I say, they're very robotic and very like somebody who's reading something off of
Wikipedia
and saying, and this is the 1970. And yeah, it's really robotic sounding, but at least it's natural. It's a proper conversation, and when you have a proper conversation, it goes on tangents. All sorts of interesting stuff can come out, as it does. So I like the fact the show is like that we go into tangents and we all have our own experiences that we put in, our own stories and stuff like this. You know?
Well, it's improvised at the end of the day. The show is improvised. So when I get my memory blanks, when I get the brain farts and I can't think of anything, it's partly to do with the fact that it is improvised, and then partly due to the fact that I've been sniffing glue all day in the studio as well. So. You know, I'm never quite 100% with it. So that's just a fact of life. That's just the way I am. And you know, like with Nathan on his tangents of chaos, sorcery, and all the this type of stuff. It's what makes us who we are.
It definitely, that's what makes him interesting. Because at least I think show should have personality. Every show should have personality rather than be bland or rather be someone reading out facts. So you know, people either like our personalities or they don't. If they like our personalities, then come in and join us and you're sitting on conversations and have fun. You know, so we want people to feel informed but also enjoy the show and have a good laugh. But we don't take ourselves too seriously, do we? You know, we like to have fun as well, but we are serious about what we talk about, but we like to have fun as well. So I think keeping it as human and natural as possible, you know, keeping it as it is. I think
some of the best feedback and reviews we get is it basically compares us to listening to people having a conversation down the pub, which is good because when you're down the pub and you're listening to conversations, they generally are quite interesting. Without, obviously, we don't have the alcohol. That's the only problem.
We'll have to change that. We'll have to change that. If you want to subscribe to send us a crate of alcohol each month, then and myself and Dan and Nathan drunk, imagine what a show would be like that with us pissed.
We could get sponsored by a different, like, I don't know, micro breweries that could send us some of their hooch and we could drink it throughout the show. And plug it all the way. And so, yeah, if anyone out there wants to break the ice by sending us a crate of your homebrew, we'll drink it live on the podcast. And, well, we'll see what we're left with at the end of it.
See what happens. Yeah, if you think me, yourself and Nathan catch some weird things in a Fortean Oracle when we're sober, imagine what it's like when we've had a few.
Yeah. So, great. Well, let's wrap it up. So if you've made it sort of through to whatever, we must be at nearly 3 hours now for this show, if you've made it through this far and you've enjoyed it, pop on over to iTunes and leave us a short 5-star review. It helps us get up the ratings and gets more people interested in the show, and we'd really appreciate it. And there's always Patreon, and there's always subscribing to us via PayPal, and we'll send you lots of free stuff. And if you really want, we'll send you you can have an autograph if you really want one. I get asked for autographs in America, but never in the UK. So
definitely. Well, we could bring out a calendar. Do you know what I mean? Me, yourself, and Nathan. Do you know what I mean?
Like calendar girls. Naked with a Ouija board in front of you.
Oh, the Ouija boards, yeah, and a shrunken head or something like that, you know?
It wouldn't be a shrunken head for me. I'd have to have a full size one.
Full size head, yeah. I've got a full size human head here.
Preferably not with the mouth facing towards me.
That could be done for that. Some people may enjoy looking at that, you never know.
They might do, yeah. So you never know.
Some illegal sites.
Yeah, well, on that note. We will see
on that
you
bombshell.
On that bombshell. Yeah. On that note, we'll see you for episode number 21, which will be out in May. And until then, stay spooky. Take care.
Yep. Thanks for listening. Thank you.
Well, I wrote this song for the Christian youth. I want to teach kids the Christian truth. If you want to reach those kids on the street, then you got to do a rap to a hip-hop beat. So I gave my sermon an urban kick. My rhymes are fly, my beats are sick. My crew is big and it keeps getting bigger. That's 'cause Jesus Christ is my nigga.